here we are, and obviously a lot has happened since, when was it? It was like 1 o'clock in the afternoon, UK time, when I got offline and went and started doing my day job, and it's sort of real hard to kind of, you know, there's so much news to sift through. For those that didn't catch this morning's stream, just to sort of give you a brief outline of my day, I got called at, like I say, about somewhere between 4 or 5 by a friend I hadn't talked to in a while in Kiev, and they're a reservist, and so they were like, you know, there's a chance I'm gonna get sort of shipped off to the front. Looks like it's happening. Obviously I'm fucking disoriented, you know, just woke up, and you know, I was one of those people that really didn't think there would be a sort of boots on the ground invasion of Ukraine. Didn't seem plausible, didn't seem to sort of achieve any goals that would be worth attaining. I always felt it was macho posturing to get everyone round a table and defer Ukraine's entry into NATO for a few years. I honestly thought that was the end game. So, very weird spot to kind of end up in. But as I said for that first stream, and I'll just reiterate it now, what I wanted to do was kind of explain that, because you're going to see a lot of hyperbole. We're going to cover some of that tonight. You know, you're going to see a lot of hyperbole. You're going to see a lot of very basic takes. For example, what is being pushed at the moment in the media is that this all happened in a vacuum. Putin is Hitler too. He's invaded the Ukraine for no reason except he hates freedom, hates humanity, etc., etc. And so what we did in this morning's stream was just outline the history of how we got to this point. Kind of started in 2013, and obviously, you know, pre-annexation of Crimea and all of that stuff. And then obviously to the current day, where for my opinion, we could have definitely averted this. We could have got off this fucking merry-go-round prior to this point. Also, I saw like bizarre questions, like what side are you on? And obviously, I mean, like, and I don't know what, like, what, like, if that's like a, are you on the side of Russia or the side of Ukraine kind of question? Really bizarre. You know, I'm on the side of, you know, freedom for everybody without question across the globe. And obviously I'm anti-violence and anti-war. These things shouldn't happen. And the other point I made this morning, and I'm sure I'll show you footage that proves this to be true, a significant portion of the Russian people are absolutely vehemently against this. They don't want this at all. And we've got protests rolling now in Russia, anti-war protests, where Putin is sent in his jackbooted thug police to quell dissidents. And by the way, if you were calling for another set of protesters to get fucking truncheoned a week ago, and now you're calling it appalling, fuck you. This is why you stand for a principle. This is why you stand for the right to protest. But we won't get into that, because it's going to be divisive and weird enough. The other point is, I'm trying to pull my information from sources that I respect. And I, in that VOD, you'll find I reeled some off, which are really good sources of independent information, independent journalism that can be trusted. Because, unfortunately, in the build-up to this situation, it's unquestionable that the DNC colluding corporate media, and I would even go as far as say, I don't think it would matter if it was a Republican government anyway. If there's one thing corporate interests in America love, it's a good war, it's a good conflict. And right now, because as we know from Biden's speech, which we're probably going to watch, I just want to prepare you for the cringe. As we now know, there's almost zero likelihood NATO will deploy any troops to Ukraine. They're very much on their own. For all of the tough talk about we stand with our allies, what they mean is we stand next to our allies. And look, I'll be real with you all. This is to editorialize. You have to avoid a war with Russia at all costs if you value human life. The casualties would be, you know, unfathomable. The nature of the escalation would be horrendous and horrific. And in that sense, there is at least one kind of bizarre light at the end of the tunnel, and that is that the Chinese state came out earlier today. Yesterday, the Chinese state, prior to the invasion, said America's behavior has been immoral, in their antics and shenanigans. But today, the Chinese state officially urged both Russia and Ukraine to proceed cautiously and with a view to a resolution at the end. So as I said in that first stream, China are not all in on Russia as some fucking absolute lunatic suggested they would be. China would absolutely not operate in that way, shape or form. And they're going to be monitoring the situation, I'm sure, with interest, because obviously they do business with both Moscow and Kiev. So that's a light at the end of the tunnel. The idea that we can get to such a dystopian world landscape that we're essentially hoping China is going to act as the impartial referee in a global conflict. Yeah, fuck it, that's where we're at, I guess. But of course, as another knock-on effect of the current tumultuous geopolitical landscape, China have also made a statement saying, listen, we're having a good, long, hard look at Taiwan, and we want to make it abundantly clear, anyone drawing parallels, but this is what they said, not me. they want to make it abundantly clear, anyone drawing parallels between the Ukraine and Taiwan, it's inaccurate, because Taiwan has always been part of China. That was what they said. Things are going to get weird for the next month, few months. And listen, I'm not going to talk about this today, because it really does put it all into context. You know, I'm an older guy, 39, and I've lived a life. And, you know, I love esports. I've spent the best years of my life in esports and everything. People want me to put this geopolitical crisis through an esports lens. I can't do that because, you know, we're already talking about hundreds of casualties, maybe more. I've seen footage of jets firing rockets into civilian buildings, and I don't want to talk about whether or not a tournament's going to get cancelled in a fucking video game. I don't think that that's where I should go. Even if people want to say, "Oh, stay in your lane, use your expertise," I think it's sad. I don't know how I'm going to react. I was meant to be doing a watch party tomorrow of Eats. It kind of feels a bit weird now. You know, because there's Russian players there and Ukrainian players there, and people are having to leave Poland because it borders the, you know, and the NATO troops are moving in. And it's like, guys, like, we don't even have to finish this tournament, personally. I think with some of the people involved, it'll have a massive asterisk next to it. It's just a fucking game at the end of the day. You're going to see football matches cancelled. You're going to see large-scale events cancelled. You're going to see flights cancelled. Let's put it all in perspective. I know you thought it couldn't get any worse after the pandemic. I know that, right? But this has been simmering and percolating for a long time. And a combination of lots of things have contributed to this. Not least of all, of course, the selection of president, let's say, in America, which is always going to be a huge influence on the geopolitical landscape. But, you know, it's a real war with real lives at stake. Maybe we just put the video games down for a bit, eh? That's my thought. But anyway, because it's been an exceptionally long day, I'm going to try and sift through all of this and make sense of it for you. There'll be some disturbing stuff. There'll be some upsetting stuff. There'll be some stuff that'll turn you from zoomers to doomers. But we'll find some laughs. We'll find some levity in all of this, and we'll do that via the way of our favourite medium, laughing at how Americans make it all about them on Twitter. Because I have seen, it never ceases to amaze me how staggeringly bad an opinion can be forged in the mind of a terminally online American. It's actually a gift in a way that they can come up with these. And so we'll explore some of that. The tweets I've seen, this term gets bandied a lot around by the shitlibs, you know, Eurocentric. There is no more nation or group of people on earth more centric than modern day America. It would be absurd to suggest otherwise. We all bow and scrape to you online. We all respect your monoculture as being the rules that we all have to adhere to, despite many of us being ancient cultures and ancient peoples with histories that far eclipse yours. But no, we all have to, you know, Yes, America. There is no more self-centered nation, culturally speaking, than modern America. We'll definitely fucking have a look at that for sure. Because a lot of that, by the way, is going to shape the messaging around this conflict and the aftermath of this conflict. The other thing I said in the VOD, and then we're going to get into the coverage for real. The other thing I said in this morning's broadcast was basically, don't go to the American corporate media to get your messaging on this. It's going to be hard to avoid because a lot of us go to CNN. You know, I've got my own views about this and I don't want to stray into bizarre, deranged editorializing. I saw a number of CNN videos today talk about right place, right time. I don't like it. It feels weird. I don't like news as sort of a wag the dog kind of like stir the emotions, you know, kind of thing. Yeah, I think you have to have a responsibility to really tell the honest story and not just reduce it to a series of emotionally manipulative vignettes. And yet, that is how the American media has been covering news since I studied it, since I literally studied, you know, the first Iraq Kuwait conflict, which was the first sort of, I mean, technically, you know, Vietnam was the first televised war, is what they say. But for a lot of us people in Europe, the first time we ever saw anything akin to modern warfare being brought onto our, you know, 24-hour news feeds, which didn't exist in Vietnam, was the Iraq Kuwait. I remember distinctly, I saw live coverage on American media of a missile being launched into a building through an air duct with night vision following it all the way, as if this was like a really cool thing. And that was done to say, hey, look, modern warfare, no casualties. Don't worry about it. We can pinpoint accuracy an American missile where we can shoot it into an air duct of a building from, you know, thousands of miles away. And of course, you know, this was to prime the pump of the American consciousness that there would be no civilian casualties, there would be no collateral damage. And we all know it was a fucking disaster. So American media coverage around wars is gross, and nothing could illustrate it better than what I saw today, just crossing my feet. You have to laugh in a way, really. It's so ridiculous. This war brought to you by Applebee's. I mean, it's fucking insane. It's insane. This is why I can't fuck with the US media. I can't. It's fucking insane, guys. Like this corporate drive. There's no one that can press a button and stop that. Really? It's as bad as you think it is, but then it's worse. So, right, where do we start with all of this? So, what happened in the, I don't know, 8, 9 hours while I was working? Well, let's bring you up to speed. We've had a number of big developments. Of course, we've been following the battles as they're happening. There have been some misinformation and everything else. One of the things we might get to when we have time is we might take a look a little bit at how Putin framed it all, because I talked about his unhinged speech, or he's all slumped in a chair, like the last scene of Scarface. And he rambled incoherently for an hour, like it was me telling a short anecdote. And it's mental. Like, listen, I am not one for hyperbole. I try and stay away from that, especially around serious topics. Like, it can be entertaining as a comedic device, but I think his box is gone. I think he's lost his fucking mind. I think he has absolutely lost his mind. He is consistently talking about how he's going to overthrow the Nazi regime in the Ukraine. You know, Zelensky, who I believe is of Jewish origin. The idea you're ever going to, you know, it's fucking wild what he's saying. And I think he's lost his marbles. I think Putin has lost his marbles. I really do. This is like the first time I've ever sort of witnessed something like this in my lifetime. And I've seen wars, and I've seen the Cold War, and I've seen all of that unfold. That 60-minute speech he gave, I was kind of like watching it in the background while I was doing some work in the downtime. It is mental. It is mental. I didn't even realize how bad it was because I'd only seen snippets. I hadn't watched the whole thing through. It is all over the place. And in that regard, I think it's actually quite intelligent that how the international community has framed it by talking directly to the Russian people. By saying to the Russian people, like, I know you don't want this too. We're neighbors. We've got a shared history. It's your leadership that's doing this. And obviously, this has spurred on these protests. But I honestly, legitimately think Putin has lost his fucking marbles. Just, I can show you some footage here, actually, of those protests. These have sprung up all across Russia in a show of solidarity that they don't want to have this war. They don't want to have this invasion. Let me show you just the sheer size of the crowd. This is footage from Ragip Soylu, who is the chief of the Turkey Bureau for Middle East Eye. This is his footage, I believe. And so you can see it's already sizable. When you consider we're talking about these protests happening in Russia as well, these people know the risks they're taking, that the Russian state will come in and will react to this. Some more footage from Alexander S. Vindman. There are sizable protests breaking out now across Russia, protesting the war. So obviously, what does Biden do? Well, Biden has fucking sent in the boys, as I was telling you at the start of the stream, and I've got some footage of that here. But this is from the account I told you go and follow earlier, Alec Loon, the independent journalist. He's been pulling together all footage from all over the world, and here we go. This is what they're doing. They've been basically beating people. And into the van you go, and I'm sure that person is gonna get due process and all of their rights in one of Putin's jails. No, of course not. And so far, estimates according to several sources at the moment say there's been 1700 in excess of 1700 arrests just from these protests that are coming up, and trust me, that number is going to be far, far greater. So again, just want to reiterate, peaceful protest, good. We also had a number of developments, which includes there have been a number of confirmed aircraft brought down by the Ukrainians to begin with, but there's now been a lot of counter-offensives. Russia seems to have occupied a lot of territory. In fact, a lot of people are saying online that this has been an alarmingly easy ground invasion. Some people have compared it to the capitulation of the troops in Afghanistan when the Taliban invaded amidst Biden's disastrous withdrawal, which I've also covered. You can go check that out on YouTube if you want to know more about that. That it says that there's been 14 deaths. It was a Ukrainian military plane that was shot down. And so, you know, we're currently tallying up the casualties. We don't really know where we're at overall. Again, estimates are saying there've been a number of civilian casualties. I think the last official count was that there was 40 confirmed civilian casualties and hundreds of troops that had died. It's been ongoing, as I said. So there you go. Thank you, Jice. Latest count on that is 57 Ukrainians killed overall, 169 injuries. That's the civilian tally, I believe. So, you know, and expect that number to go up. The evacuations in Kiev have continued. I'm sure you've seen the footage of people that have been going all the way, huge convoys of vehicles trying to flee the city. This has prompted a reaction from the Ukrainian government Now, if you know, the Ukrainian government declared martial law, obviously, because you're in a combat situation. And this has meant that they're now starting to ration fuel. Each vehicle that's leaving Kiev right now, or other major Ukrainian cities, not just Kiev, they're only going to be allowed 20 liters of fuel each. So this could have some knock-on effects of people physically not being able to get far away enough from the conflict. There's currently, if you look at where people are, there's been advancements onto Kiev. They've taken a major airport, something like 25 miles away from Kiev, according to CNN. We've got footage of that here. This is where, again, guys, I'm not going to do a lot of US corporate media coverage for obvious reasons. But I will just show you that this is one of those ones where it just happens to be a bit too weird and a bit too neat for me. The same journalistic outlet just so happened to be near a chain of explosions about 2, 3 hours prior to this incredible footage.
In the middle of the fighting, Matthew, tell us what you're witnessing
there.
Stop, stop.
Jim, we've come out of the center of the Ukrainian capital, Kiev. And we are here at the Antonov Airport, which is about 25 kilometers, 15 miles or so out of the center. These troops you can see over here. Stand up, Lewis. These troops you can see over here, they are Russian airborne forces. They have taken this airport. They've allowed us to come in and be with them as they defend the perimeter of this air base here, where helicopter-borne troops, these troops, were landed in the early hours of this morning to take and to form an air bridge to allow for more troops to come in. You can see these are Russian forces. You can tell they're Russian. I've spoken to them already. You can tell they're Russian. They've got that orange and black band to identify them as Russian forces. I've spoken to the commander on the ground there within the past few minutes, and he said they are now in control of this airport. And within the past few seconds, just before you came to us, they were engaged in a firefight, presumably with the Ukrainian military, which says
camera's not rolling for
it is staging a counter-offensive to try and take back this airport. We can tell you now, I'm standing outside the...
Currently there are attempts ongoing, and again, you know, I'm on a delay. I'm getting this information coming through news feeds, and it's all going to be staggered out. But currently there is a you know, ongoing effort by Ukrainian forces to take that airport back. Some people have suggested it has been reclaimed. I don't think that is the case. It looks like combat is ongoing. And indeed, if Ukraine have taken back something like an airport of strategic importance, I would have thought it would be parroted a little bit more. In reality, all the footage I'm seeing of the conflicts strongly suggest that this has been something of a cakewalk. In fact, there are reports saying Putin has actually only deployed a fraction of his troops and is still gaining ground militarily in Ukraine, which really brings us back to sort of questioning everything that the head of NATO said when they were talking about how we've been providing them with modern weaponry, and, you know, we've been bolstering up their military forces with training and all of this stuff. So far, everything I'm seeing is Russia's taking this. So, you know, something to be mindful of. There has been fighting near Chernobyl, obviously the infamous nuclear plant. You can see here, this is, again, a report from Al Jazeera. Major gun battle breaks out between Russian and Ukrainian forces at the stricken radioactive site, with its safety status now unclear. And it was spread on Twitter that a nuclear waste storage facility had been damaged in the firefight. And to worry, because there was a chance that there was going to be nuclear waste breaching out. Now, that's all been corrected subsequently. But this is the type of thing that you're going to see spread across social media. The idea that there's been sort of a nuclear breach is, again, just another panic that people are going to spread. That's absolutely not the case as things stand. But you can see here, the condition of the plant's facilities, a confinement shelter and a repository for nuclear waste, is unknown. And Ikor Novikov, who was a former advisor to the current Ukraine President Zelensky, said that the threat to Europe from the incapacitated nuclear facility needs to be taken extremely seriously. I'd say first and foremost, we need help explaining the dangers to our friends in the West. I mean, Ukraine has 15 active nuclear reactors and nuclear waste in Chernobyl. One more to miss and everyone in Europe is facing a major nuclear catastrophe. Now, I'm pretty sure that is, it's something to be mindful of, but I don't think it's anything to worry about. And it certainly hasn't happened. If you've read that there's been a breach at the Chernobyl plant, that isn't true. That's not what's happened. That was erroneous information put out by a journalist that jumped the gun a little bit on the story. So, obviously, we've all been waiting to see what the big dog would say. And Joe Biden has come out of the nap cave and has delivered his speech and fielded questions from journalists. And as you can imagine, there's been mixed reaction, let's say, to it. I'll put the speech on. Things that are abundantly clear at this point. They are going to sanction Putin. They're going to sanction Russia. They are going to sanction Russian oligarchs in NATO and NATO-allied countries around the world. But clearly the taste to commit troops to go into Ukraine to facilitate the Ukrainian resistance is a no-no. That will not happen. I pretty much said as much. And if you watch the NATO speech this morning, then yes, tonality, you can see that it's not going to happen. All the people that have been memeing about World War III, World War III, World War III, the reality is that isn't going to happen because nobody is going to commit troops to the Ukraine because of what that would do to the world, essentially. But here we go.
A junta of neo-Nazis.
Richard, I'm going to have to interrupt you. The president is at the podium now.
The Russian military has begun a brutal assault on the people of Ukraine. Without provocation, without justification, without necessity, this is a premeditated attack. Vladimir Putin has been planning this for months, as we've been saying all along. He moved more than 175,000 troops, military equipment in positions along the Ukrainian border. He moved blood supplies into position and built a field hospital, which tells you all you need to know about his intentions all along. He rejected every good faith effort the United States and our allies and partners made to address our mutual security concerns through dialogue to avoid needless conflict and avert human suffering. For weeks, we have been warning that this would happen. And now it's unfolding largely as we predicted.
And get used to this, because the messaging around this invasion from the DNC is that they knew it was coming. Their intelligence knew it was coming. It's all happening as it was predicted, planned even, which, if you remember, is exactly what they said when Afghanistan collapsed and within hours the Taliban had reclaimed the country. Incredible to think that's the message you're going to go with. We knew it would happen. We did nothing to stop it. We tried talking to them. We tried saying, we'll sanction you. And when that didn't work, gee willikers, we were all out of ideas. That's the messaging they're going to go with. Fortunately for Biden, the messaging, which is terrible, and this speech, which is painful to listen to, isn't going to affect his approval in a negative way. Actually, his approval can only go up because the American people have a tendency to rally around presidential figures, irrespective of political party, when they're in a perceived global conflict. He knows this. They know this. The media knows this. And so as a result, put it this way, it's embarrassing that Boris Johnson was more statesmanlike, more authoritative in his speech earlier today compared to the dribble you're about to sit through.
In the past week, we've seen shelling increase in the Donbas, a region in eastern Ukraine controlled by Russian-backed separatists. The Russian government has perpetrated cyber attacks against Ukraine. We saw a staged political theater in Moscow, outlandish and baseless claims that Ukraine was about to invade and launch a war against Russia. that Ukraine was prepared to use chemical weapons. The Ukraine committed a genocide without any evidence. We saw a flagrant violation of international law in attempting to unilaterally create two new so-called republics on sovereign Ukrainian territory. And at the very moment that the United Nations Security Council was meeting to stand up for Ukraine's sovereignty, to stave off invasion, Putin declared his war. Within moments, missile strikes began to fall on historic cities across Ukraine. Then came the air raids, followed by tanks and troops rolling in. We've been transparent with the world. We've shared declassified evidence about Russia's plans and cyber attacks and false pretexts. So,
just on this point about them declassifying documents and Biden saying we've been transparent with the world, hilarious, of course, because the American government is anything but transparent with the world. But as a build up to this, one of the things they did do to sort of attempt again, in a kind of manufacturing consent kind of way, they released declassified documents, intelligence documents that pointed to Russian government assets and allies engaging in hostile activities in the Ukraine. On top of that, of course, you famously, I think we might even have watched that clip on a stream, right, with that journalist saying, what do you mean? And Biden's foreign press secretary was saying, listen, Russia are going to attempt to do a deep fake and some disinformation, and it's going to be a predicate for war. But we can't tell you what, we can't tell you how we know, but just trust us. And of course, the journalist was incredibly frustrated. That all pertains to that, this idea that the US were trying to essentially get it out there as quickly as possible. Like, Putin will not be deterred. There is going to be an invasion. It's definitely going to happen. They're already doing all this negative shit. And trust us, it's coming in the pipe.
No confusion or cover-up about what Putin was doing. Putin is the aggressor. Putin chose this war. And now he and his country will bear the consequences. Today, I'm authorizing additional strong sanctions and new limitations on what can be exported to Russia. This is going to impose severe costs on the Russian economy, both immediately and over time. We have purposely designed these sanctions to maximize the long-term impact on Russia and to minimize the impact on the United States and our allies. I want to be clear, the United States is not doing this alone. For months, we've been building a coalition of partners representing well more than half the global economy. 27 members of the European Union, including France, Germany, Italy, as well as the United Kingdom, Canada, Japan, Australia, New Zealand, and many others, to amplify the joint impact of our response. I just spoke with the G7 leaders this morning, and we're in full and total agreement. We will limit Russia's ability to do business in dollars, euros, pounds, and yen to be part of the global economy. We'll limit their...
Wait, hang on. No, you don't need to ban. You don't need to ban him. You were one of the people saying USA could just be spreading propaganda and believe Russia might not invade. How is that contradictory? You're doing that thing, bro. Like, listen, you're a regular. I don't mind them banning you because you've been around for time, I think. I see you following us all the time, but like, listen, here's the thing. Time moves forward linearly. America would spread propaganda, right? They do. Like, I didn't, yeah, I opened up today's stream by saying I didn't think they would invade. It's okay to be wrong. It's especially okay for me to be wrong on matters of geopolitics when I'm not a government operative and I don't have access to fucking intelligence, do I? I don't have access to military and political intelligence. It's weird that you think it's contradictory. If you can't see that that isn't contradictory, you probably shouldn't engage with political content, as I doubt you lack the sort of intellectual capacity for that. So, just saying.
Do that. We're going to stunt the ability to finance and grow the Russian military. We're going to impose major, and we're going to impair their ability to compete in high-tech 21st century economy. We've already seen the impact of our actions on Russia's currency and the ruble, which early today hit its weakest level ever in history. The Russia stock market plunged today. The Russian government borrowing rates spiked by...
That's actually true. I think I've got the graph. Let me see if I can bring it up for you. Yeah, here it is. This'll do. But yeah, as you can see here from the CNN report, the Russian stock market has crashed 33%, and the ruble is now at a record low for value. So we're looking at a financial crisis as well. And that's before we start getting into the sanctions that Biden's going to talk at length about. We start looking at banks being froze, the pressure for Russia to be removed from SWIFT, which is currently being resisted by some nations, including Germany. This is going to be bad for the Russian people.
Over 15%. In today's actions, we've now sanctioned Russian banks that together hold around $1 trillion in assets. We've cut off Russia's largest bank, a bank that holds more than one-third of Russia's banking assets by itself, cut it off from the U.S. financial system. And today, we're also blocking four more major banks. That means every asset they have in America will be frozen. This includes VTB, the second largest bank in Russia, which has $250 billion in assets. As promised, we're also adding the names to the list of Russian elites and their family members that are sanctioning, that were sanctioned as well. As I said on Tuesday, these are people who personally gain from the Kremlin's policies, and they should share in the pain. We will keep up this drumbeat of those designations against corrupt billionaires in the days ahead. On Tuesday, we stopped the Russian government from raising money from U.S. or European investors. Now we're going to apply the same restrictions to Russia's largest state-owned enterprises, companies with assets that exceed $1.4 trillion. Some of the most powerful impacts our actions will come over time as we squeeze Russia's access to finances and technology for strategic sectors of its economy and degrade its industrial capacity for years to come. Between our actions and those of our allies and partners, we estimate that we'll cut off more than half of Russia's high-tech imports. It will strike a blow to their ability to continue to modernize their military. It will degrade their aerospace industry, including their space program. It will hurt their ability to build ships, reducing their ability to compete economically. And it will be a major hit to Putin's long-term strategic ambitions. And we're preparing to do more. In addition to the economic penalties we're imposing, we're also taking steps to defend our NATO allies, particularly in the East. Tomorrow, NATO will convene a summit. We'll be there to bring together the leaders of 30 allied nations and close partners to affirm our solidarity and to map out the next steps we will take to further strengthen all aspects of our NATO alliance. Although we provided over $650 million in defensive assistance to Ukraine just this year, it's last year, let me say it again. Our forces are not and will not be engaged in the conflict with Russia.
Still struggling with, much like that guy from earlier, struggling with the concept of linear time. But he's got different reasons, hasn't he?
In Ukraine. Our forces are not going to Europe to fight in Ukraine, but to defend our NATO allies and reassure those allies in the East.
And you noticed it there, and this is a point that's expanded on a little bit later. It's very explicit. We're going to strengthen our NATO allies, but our troops will not be fighting in Ukraine. It's not happening, guys. Like, I've seen so many people say, yeah, but what if it changes after the meeting with the G7? Like, again, so I was wrong about the invasion in the first instance. I don't think I'm wrong about this. When I saw the polling, it was at something like, 28% of people support troops going to Ukraine, and everyone else is like either indifferent or doesn't want it. This is a result of a number of sort of frivolous bullshit forever wars that America is engaged in, sort of just taking away people's appetite for it, and a number of other things as well. There is just no way any NATO country can just put troops in the Ukraine. It's like, even as an ally, they can't do it.
As I made crystal clear, The United States will defend every inch of NATO territory with the full force of American power. And the good news is, NATO is more united and more determined than ever. There is no doubt, no doubt that the United States and every NATO ally will meet our Article 5 commitments, which says an attack on one is an attack on all. Over the past few weeks, I ordered thousands of additional forces to Germany and Poland as part of our commitment to NATO. On Tuesday, in response to Russia's aggressive action, including its troop presence in Belarus and the Black Sea, I've authorized deployment of ground and air forces already stationed in Europe to NATO's eastern flank allies, Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, Poland, and Romania. Our allies have also been stepping up, adding the other allies, the rest of NATO, adding their own forces and capabilities to ensure collective defense. And today, within hours of Russia's unleashing its assault, NATO came together and authorized and activated an activation of response plans. This will enable NATO's high readiness forces to deploy and when and where they are needed to protect our NATO allies on the eastern boundaries of Europe. And now I'm authorizing additional U.S. force capabilities to deploy to Germany as part of NATO's response, including some of the U.S.-based forces that the Department of Defense placed on standby weeks ago. I've also spoken with Defense Secretary Austin and Chairman of the Joint Chiefs General Milley about preparations for additional moves should they become necessary to protect our NATO allies and support the greatest military alliance in the history of the world, NATO. As we respond, my administration is using the tools, every tool at its disposal, to protect American families.
He's getting that point of his speech where he's gonna start to struggle now. You know, like, the good drugs can only last so long, unfortunately. And as I'll show you, he fucks it up right royally in the Q&A. Says some ridiculous stuff that actively undoes the main thrust of his speech, because why not?
Families and businesses from rising prices at the gas pump. You know, we're taking active steps to bring down the cost, and American oil and gas companies should not exploit this moment to hike their prices to raise profits. You know, in our sanctions package, we specifically designed to allow energy payments to continue. We are closely monitoring energy supplies for any disruption. We've been coordinating with major oil producing and consuming countries toward our common interest to secure global energy supplies. We are actively working with countries around the world to elevate collective release from the strategic petroleum reserves of major energy consuming countries. And the United States will release additional barrels of oil as conditions warrant. I know this is hard and that Americans are already hurting. I will do everything in my power to limit the pain the American people are feeling at the gas pump. This is critical to me. But this aggression cannot go unanswered. If it did, the consequences for America would be much worse. America stands up to bullies. We stand up for freedom. This is who we are. Let me also repeat the warning I made last week. If Russia pursues cyber attacks against our companies, our critical infrastructure, we are prepared to respond. For months,
In what way, Joe?
We've been working closely with the private sector to harden their cyber defenses, sharpen our ability to respond to Russian cyber attacks as well. I spoke last night to President Zelensky of Ukraine, and I assured him that the United States, together with our allies and partners in Europe, will support the Ukrainian people as they defend their country. We'll provide humanitarian relief to ease their suffering. And in the early days of this conflict, Russia propaganda outlets will keep trying to hide the truth and claim success for its military operation against a made-up threat. But history has shown, time and again, how swift gains in territory eventually give way to grinding occupations, acts of mass civil disobedience, and strategic dead ends. The next few weeks and months, we hard on the people of Ukraine. Putin has unleashed a great pain on them. But the Ukrainian people have known 30 years of independence. They've repeatedly shown that they will not tolerate anyone who tries to take their country backwards. This is a dangerous moment for all of Europe, for the freedom around the world. Putin has committed an assault on the very principles that uphold the global peace. But now, the entire world sees clearly what Putin and his Kremlin and his Kremlin allies are really all about. This was never about a genuine security concerns on their part. It was always about naked aggression, about Putin's desire for empire by any means necessary, by bullying Russia's neighbors through coercion and corruption, by changing borders by force, and ultimately by choosing a war without a cause. Putin's actions betray his sinister vision for the future of our world, one where nations take what they want by force.
I mean, I'll also just add, there's a component to all of this that I didn't talk about earlier, and you sort of have to be mindful of it, right? You remember how Trump was meant to be a Putin asset, right? You remember that, even though he did loads of sanctions and almost got into an open conflict with Russia around his handling of the Syrian conflict. Well, it's interesting, right? A lot of people have asked, like, oh, what would have happened if Trump was president, you know? And my read on it is, I don't think we would be here. And why is that? Well, let me sort of break it down a little bit. If Trump had been president again, we wouldn't have had all of this. We wouldn't have had an administration that has actively said, and this doesn't, it doesn't matter whether it's accurate or not. A lot of it was made up hysteria, but there's aspects of it that are true. But, you know, a U.S. administration that has actively said Russia is an existential threat to the U.S. You can't trust Russia. Remember that fake story about how the Russian agents had hacked the U.S. power grid, and it turned out to be completely false, an absolute whole cloth fabrication, not an element of truth to it. This is the administration that used their friends in the media to push a completely fake dossier that said Putin had compromising material on Donald Trump in the form of a tape where he made prostitutes urinate on a bed that Obama once slept in. Something that was essentially a fucking fan fiction written on 4chan that some DNC paid political operative cobbled together, calling it unverified intelligence, paid for by the DNC. A dossier so full of holes and nonsense that not even CNN would run it. And in the end, BuzzFeed News ran it, and then CNN reported on the BuzzFeed News story, and it blew it all up. And it's just been an endless, like, Russia's the enemy, Russia's the enemy, Russia's the enemy. So when Biden says he's chosen a war of aggression, and there's absolutely no grounds for it, Putin made it abundantly clear Ukraine can't be in NATO. Ukraine was seduced and told by all of the NATO nations and all of the European nations that are allied with NATO, don't worry about it, stand up, take a hard line with Putin, we'll back you to the hilt. Now they're finding out the reality, they won't send troops on the ground, even though you are an ally. And second of all, Putin, if he has any worries whether or not he can trust Americans, and you'll notice from his speech and his speeches, he's talking openly about how he doesn't trust NATO, particularly with this American administration in charge. And that's because they've spent all this time talking about Russia as being enemies. So it's a little bit more complicated, Joe. It's a little bit more complicated than Putin just did this because he woke up one day and thought, fuck it. You know, you haven't helped, have you? You have deliberately eroded the relationship between the US and Russia. Whereas under Trump, it probably could have been maintained in some vestige of what it had before. A few flashpoints here and there, but ultimately firm handshakes and let's not fuck around with each other. Let's all make money. And people went, that's wrong. This is better, apparently. That's just the reality. That's just, this is all true. It doesn't mean I support Putin. Doesn't mean I support the Russian invasion of Ukraine. But when you have the President of the United States publicly saying, oh, he just decided to do it. It's like, no, you broke down all international trust with your LARPing about Donald Trump these past 5-6 years.
There's a vision that the United States and freedom-loving nations everywhere will oppose with every tool of our considerable power. The United States and our allies and partners will emerge from this stronger, more united, more determined, and more purposeful. And Putin's aggression against Ukraine will end up costing Russia dearly, economically and strategically. We will make sure of that. Putin will be a pariah on the international stage. Any nation that countenances Russia's naked aggression against Ukraine will be stained by association. When the history of this era is written, Putin's choice to make a totally unjustifiable war on Ukraine will have left Russia weaker and the rest of the world stronger. Liberty, democracy, human dignity, these are the forces far more powerful than fear and oppression. They cannot be extinguished by tyrants like Putin and his armies. They cannot be erased by people from people's hearts and hopes by any amount of violence.
Listen, whenever I watch a Biden speech, one thought just resonates in my brain. I wish, rather than have to listen to him try and read the teleprompter, why don't you just put the teleprompter up there for us to read? And we could all have a much, much better time. I think it would be better for all parties if we just did that, right? Like, because this is a fucking nightmare.
They endure in the contest between democracy and autocracy, between sovereignty and subjugation. Make no mistake, freedom will prevail. God bless the people of a free and democratic Ukraine, and may God protect our troops. And intimidation. They endure in the contest between democracy and autocracy, between sovereignty and subjugation. Make no mistake, freedom will prevail. God bless the people of a free and democratic Ukraine, and may God protect our troops. Associated Press, Zeke.
Oh, yeah. I mean, please, like, it's just ridiculous. And of course, remember, it's a stutter, and there's nothing wrong with this. We all misspeak. We all do it. I do it. It's not normal. This is fine.
So do you have any plans to speak with President Putin at this point? And what interactions have you had with the Russian government?
I heard the first part. Do I have any plans to speak with Putin at this point? And what?
What communications have you had with the Kremlin as far as military operations in Ukraine and making sure this does not spiral into a larger conflict?
Well, it's a large conflict already. The way we're going to ensure it's not going to aspire to a larger conflict is by providing all the forces needed.
Get the adrenochrome. He's going. He's tipping over. Get the adrenochrome. Holy shit, that was like Blur from Transformers. I couldn't understand a fucking word he was saying.
In the Eastern European nations that are members of NATO. NATO is more united than it's ever been. And I have no plans to talk with Putin.
Right, and again, so this is another thing, right? Like, are we saying, right? And you know, we talked about this earlier with NATO. NATO wouldn't answer direct questions from the press where they were asked, and they said, "Can Russia come back to the table and discuss things with NATO?" Now, obviously, the end game of this has to be some sort of negotiations. Like, or what are we talking about? So let's imagine a world, right? Ukraine falls. It's now being reabsorbed into Russia. And Putin thinks, well, that was fucking easy. Let's go get a few of these other countries. Starts eyeing up other ones, right? At what point are we going to fucking get involved? And surely, before getting involved, wouldn't the option to have some sort of, I don't know, negotiations, like if we could all get around the table now and stop this, that'd probably be preferable to letting it continue. And yet, you know, when Biden says, I have no plans to sort of talk to Putin, like I will never going to talk to Putin again. I sort of worry about that because NATO wouldn't rule that out. NATO, right? Which US is a member of. So what do you... That's fucking insane.
Wall Street Journal, Tarina.
Mr. President, you didn't mention SWIFT in your sanctions that you announced. Is there a reason why the U.S. Isn't doing that? Is there a disagreement among allies regarding SWIFT and whether Russia should be allowed to be a part of it?
The sanctions that we have proposed on all their banks have of equal consequence, maybe more consequence than SWIFT, number one. Number two...
Not too sure about that. I need to fact check it, though.
It is always an option, but right now that's not the position that the rest of Europe wishes to take.
So, yeah, this is about SWIFT. There is a conflict between the NATO allies, and particularly among European countries, where what we're looking to do is essentially make it so Russia is kicked out of the SWIFT banking system, which SWIFT stands for Society for Worldwide Interbank Financial Telecommunication. And it was formed in the 70s, like a lot of things, including NATO. It's headquartered in Belgium. It partners with other banks, including the Federal Reserve, you know, Bank of England. But what it is it doesn't work like a bank. It doesn't work with the transference of money, but it's more like a secure system that alerts banks that transactions are going through. So without that, you can't transfer money because there's none of that security and none of that messaging between all the electronic systems around the world. So if you are exiled from SWIFT, it's very hard to sort of operate financially. And so a number of the European countries in NATO are currently having a discussion about what to do, and that one of the hardest sanctions that you could probably hit Russia with would of course be to remove them from SWIFT. Interestingly enough, you saw, this is what I mean when I say, you know, Boris Johnson is more statesmanlike, more dare I say presidential than the president. Obviously we have prime ministers, don't we? But you can see here he's pushing for it. He wants them out, and this is Boris Johnson pushing, as from earlier today, Boris Johnson pushes for Russia to be ejected from the SWIFT payment system. But Germany warns against the move ahead of an emergency EU meeting. And there were a number of nations, it wasn't just Germany, although Germany are unquestionably, obviously with the, you know, the Bundesbank and everything else, they're unquestionably one of the bigger voices in the room, let's say. But it was actually Germany, Italy, Hungary, and Cyprus. And Cyprus, by the way, because of how they work, Cyprus is, in my understanding at least, they're sort of an international business partner with Russia. They have lots of like sort of private enterprises that act as fronts, for want of a better word, for Russian businesses. So Cyprus were never going to be all right with this, because that would hurt their own economy massively, potentially. So you've got that. But anyway, Germany, Italy, Hungary, and Cyprus, because Cyprus are an ally of NATO and not a NATO member. Remember, allies around the table discussing this too. They're the countries that are resistant to removing Russia from SWIFT. And you just heard it there from the sleepy horse's mouth. He said, Biden, that he believes that actually the sanctions US have put together are going to hit Russia worse than the removal of SWIFT. A lot of economists disagree with that take. I think as well it was reported in The Hill. It was Reuters. Of course it was Reuters. I feel like it's always Reuters. But yeah, basically this is a report from the 24th today. Fucking hell, it's been a long one, where they're saying it's very unlikely that the EU will cut Russia off of SWIFT for now. Now, I don't know if that means that that's with a view, they still want cards to play, see how Russia react to the initial sanctions. I think it makes sense. Don't push all your chips in the middle of the table on this particular issue just yet. But obviously as well, there is resistance to it because of nations not wanting it to affect their own economy. So this is one of the problems with international commerce, the idea that you can just issue sanctions to some sort of nation that goes rogue and deviates from what you want to have happen. It doesn't always work if you're all inextricably linked to it. And that's what really surprised me about Boris Johnson saying he wants to get away from Russian money. There is so much Russian money in British politics right now. So much that for Boris Johnson to sort of reject it and say we don't care what it does is actually insane to me. So other nations, as you can see from that Swift issue, not so much.
Cecilia Vega, ABC.
This revolutionary new device can remove up to 10 times more earwax than a traditional cotton swab.
Fucking hell, that's graphic, sanctions, isn't it? I don't need that. Actually, what that wasn't a commercial for an earwax remover, right? That was actually the fucking White House doctor checking Joe Biden's brain. Well, it's fell out. It's all over.
Clearly have not been enough to deter Vladimir Putin to this point. What is going to stop him? How and when does this end? And do you see him trying to go beyond Ukraine? And a second question I'll just give to you now. This statement that he gave last night, the threat that he gave, the West will face consequences greater than any you have faced in history. Is he threatening?
Now, this was weird. This was weird, wasn't it? Because this is the question about whether or not Putin is talking about nuclear weapons, and Joe Biden's got a smile on his face. Like, I don't understand. You see, this is another thing that makes me think he's gone fucking nanas, because it's a completely inappropriate facial reaction, isn't it? Like, what is that smile about? You're being asked, do you think Putin will invade other countries and potentially launch nuclear weapons on anybody that decides to stand up to what he's doing?
A nuclear strike?
I have no idea what he's threatening. I know what he has done, number one. And number two, no one expected.
Which is also weird, because if you remember at the start of the speech, they were talking about how their intelligence is so good, so accurate, they've been able to predict all of this up until this point. But obviously they only have intelligence up until this point, and they can only predict up until this point, and now they can't predict what's going to happen in the future until after it's happened, where at which point they will claim that they actually knew that's how it was going to go all along, and this is all part of the plan, God's plan, Biden's plan.
The sanctions to prevent anything from happening. This is going to take time, and we have to show resolve so he knows what's coming. And so the people of Russia know what he's brought on them. That's what this is all about. This is going to take time. It's not going to occur. He's going to say, oh my God, these sanctions are coming, I'm going to stand down. He's going to test.
This, just listen to this again.
Number two. No one expected the sanctions to prevent anything from happening.
Now, the problem is with this, right? If you remember, the entire US strategy, the entire strategy of this administration was that the sanctions would be enough. They said as much. They were like, listen, if you do it, there'll be sanctions. Here's some sanctions. And you've just done a speech talking about how the sanctions are coming and they will be the worst they've ever felt and it'll wreck Russia for years to come. And then you just turn around to a journalist and go, yeah, we knew the sanctions were going to do fuck all. Like, holy shit, Joe, come on, man. Stay on the fucking script, mate. Just fucking please get through. And then people say to me, oh, Richard, you're a fucking right-wing demagogue, because you know you point out that, remember, this guy didn't do a fucking meet the press, didn't do open Q&A for fucking months after he was elected. It was something like 90 days, and this is why he's an absolute disaster.
This is going to take time, and we have to show resolve so he knows what's coming. And so the people of Russia know what he's brought on them. That's what this is all about. This is going to take time. It's not going to occur. He's going to say, oh my God, these sanctions are coming, I'm going to stand down. He's going to test the resolve of the West to see if we stay together, and we will. We will, and it will impose significant costs on him.
Will he go beyond Ukraine, sir? Do you see him going beyond?
Yes.
Now that's yes. Don't worry, guys. That's yes to the other thing, not yes to, he's saying yes to, he's not answering the other question about whether or not he'll go beyond the Ukraine. He's chosen not to answer that one. And because he doesn't understand anything, He's just shouted the word yes to take another question from somebody else. That can't be the answer to that.
Two topics, just really quick. First,
everyone's favorite, Fox's Peter Doocy's in the house. Sad state of affairs, isn't it, really, that the only vaguely combative questions you get is from a man who, if you don't know the history of Peter Doocy, another indictment of the US media, he is, because a lot of people, I know a lot of people who are like, you know, Trump supporters or whatever, love this guy. Remember, this entire guy's career is predicated on, he did a live special where he interviewed the special forces operative that supposedly killed Bin Laden. He did a whole special interview about it. They treated it like it was Frost Nixon, and he was there. So, you know, when you went to his cave in this very real operation, that definitely happened. Yeah, yeah. I'm not going to ask you any questions about why you suddenly decided to be mega respectful of Islamic burial rites, and no one in the general public got to see the body. I'm not going to do that. This is a special about how this real operation definitely really happened. So that, by the way, is who Peter Doocy is. So if you're ever deluded into thinking this guy's a good journalist, nah, he just asks fucking raw questions because it's a fucking Democrat president.
Markets are down and gas prices are up. I know you always stress the difference between Wall Street and Main Street, but everybody seems to be in for some economic pain. How economically painful is it going to get for people in this country? And I do have one more question.
First of all, there's no doubt that when a major nuclear power attacks and invades another country, that the world is going to respond, and markets can respond all over the world. So there's no doubt about that, number one. Number two, the notion that this is going to last for a long time is highly unlikely. As long as we continue to stay resolved in imposing the sanctions we're going to impose on Russia, period. What's your next question? I'm sorry.
The next question is, did you underestimate Putin? And would you still describe him the way that you did in the summer as a worthy adversary?
Now, let me give you a bit of context to this question and what Doocy's doing here. Biden described him as a worthy adversary, right? And today, this afternoon, while all of the fucking, you know, war correspondents were getting their bulletproof vests on and getting ready to go and do the human interest stories and bring you the footage of the war, the media had already decided what we'll focus on is there were some comments from Trump the other day, right? Where he said, oh, you know, what Putin's done is genius. He's declared those two regions independent and now he gets to go in as a peacekeeper, right? Now, by the way, all that saying is that's like a really smart way to get yourself into war and not, and from your people, make it look like you're doing a good thing. Trump's right about that. But because what they've done is they've took the word peacekeeper, took the word genius and gone, why is Donald Trump praising Putin? He was an agent all along. Well, remember, of course, Biden, your God, your Democratic president, who's definitely not a racist, definitely not a fascist, definitely just, you know, a sort of elderly Jesus in a way. He described him as a worthy adversary, which you may notice is a compliment, isn't it? Right? So what Doocy's done there, that's a little bit of, you know, clever little questioning judo, because you know, it must be awful being a fucking Democrat acolyte, because you fucking, the cognitive dissonance must drive you insane.
At the time, he was, I made it clear, as an adversary, and I said he was worthy. I didn't underestimate him. And I've read most of everything he's written. Did you read the, I shouldn't, I'm not being a wise guy. You heard the speech he made, almost an hour's worth of speeches, why he was going into Ukraine. He has much larger ambitions in Ukraine. He wants to, in fact, reestablish the former Soviet Union. That's what this is about. And I think that his ambitions are completely contrary to the place where the rest of the world has arrived.
Confident that these devastating sanctions are going to be as devastating as Russian missiles and bullets and tanks.
He wasn't trying to be a wise guy. Now here I am laughing to myself again inappropriately for the second time while you ask me a question about devastating sanctions. Okay, mate, whatever.
Yes, Russian bullets, missiles, and tanks in Ukraine. Yes, I am.
Thank you, President Biden. If sanctions cannot stop President Putin, what penalty can?
I didn't say sanctions couldn't stop him.
You've been talking about the threat of these sanctions for several weeks now.
Oh, it's a fucking car crash, bro. It's just a fucking car crash. Like, this guy is the fucking leader of the free world. Like, it's fucking insane. Yeah, I wake up every day and I'm like, you know, listen, it could never have been Hillary for me. I've said that. I'll say it till I'm blue in the face. I stand by it. If anybody who's like, you know, out there doing like a fucking, oh God, it should have been Hillary McQueen. I'm so sorry. Like, if you're like that, like you're mental, like you're out, your box is gone. She's a fucking criminal. Like she is fucking one of the most evil politicians to sort of ever operated in American politics. So it could never be her for me. But I thought Trump was a fucking terrible president in the sense that in terms of his ability to sort of deliver a speech, stay on script, be statesmanlike, he was absolutely awful. He was an embarrassment in that regard, an embarrassment to the American electoral system, an embarrassment to the international community. But holy shit, don't you miss him when you have to listen to shit like this. Don't you miss him? Even if you voted Biden, you've got to be thinking like, if only we could do like a Cyrano de Bergerac type thing, where we could have fucking, you know, Biden as the front for someone that's capable of coherent speech and consistent thought. Wouldn't that be nice? But basically, you can see there, what he said earlier, to Joe's credit, he did say, I didn't say sanctions wouldn't stop him. What, right, which is true. What you did say, Joe, just moments ago, which I know is an eternity for you because of your unfortunate condition, What you actually did say was we didn't expect sanctions to stop him invading. So let's see if these new sanctions will stop him continuing the invasion, I guess.
No. Yes, but the threat of the sanctions and imposing the sanctions and seeing the effect of the sanctions are two different things.
You listed three things.
Two different things. And we're now going to, he's going to begin to see the effect of the sanctions.
And what will that do? How will that change his mindset here, given he's
attacking
Ukraine?
Because we'll so weaken his country that he'll have to make a very, very difficult choice as to whether to continue to move toward being a second-rate power or, in fact, respond.
You said in recent weeks that big nations cannot bluff when it comes to something like this. You recently said that the idea of personally sanctioning President Putin was on the table. Is that a step that you're prepared to take? And if not,
it's not a bluff. It's on the table.
Sanctioning President Putin?
Yes.
Why not sanction him today, sir?
Mr. President?
Why not sanction him today,
sir? Mr. President, if I can, you detailed some severe and swift new sanctions today and said the impact it will have.
And moving on. Why not sanction him today, sir? Why not sanction him today, sir? Why not sanction him today? Well, obviously, I'll answer that one for you, for the journalist there. They can't, because it's like, you can't play all your cards now. You can't. If you play it all now, he's still going to finish off the invasion to the extent of whatever the end game in Putin's mind is. That's not going to change now. The only positive outcome for Ukraine is if they are able to repel the invasion, which militarily speaking is highly unlikely without Allied forces bolstering their numbers. So what you're left with is retroactive punitive measures to stop Putin further consolidating power in the region and taking further retaliatory action against neighboring countries. And so you're going to have a gradual set of sanctions that get progressively worse. Otherwise, if you just play them all on day one, there is no incentive ever, internationally speaking, for Russia to come back to the table and play ball ever again. Which, by the way, one thing I haven't talked about too much, what you've seen unfold today is the end of any potential for positive relationship with a Putin administration for as long as he remains in power or adjacent to that power. We are going to have to wait for Putin to pass away, I would imagine, before there can be any attempts at sort of rebuilding relationships with Russia now. It's over. And I would go so far as to say with Ukraine, it'll be irreparable. You're looking at another 20, 30 years before we can even sort of undo the damage that's been done to all these international relationships
over time. But given the full-scale invasion, given that you're not pursuing disconnecting Russia from what's called SWIFT, the international banking system, or other sanctions at your disposal, respectfully, sir, what more are you waiting for?
Specifically, with the sanctions we've imposed exceed SWIFT. The sanctions we imposed exceed anything that's ever been done.
We're not going to qualify that, though. We're not going to explain that. We're not going to list what they are. We can't, in fact, at the moment.
The sanctions we imposed have generated 2/3 of the world joining us.
He might be right.
They are profound sanctions. Let's have a conversation in another month or so to see if they're working.
Can I ask you about Zelensky? Sir, you spoke to Vladimir Zelensky yesterday, sir.
What's the risk that we are watching the beginning of another Cold War, and is there now a complete rupture in U.S. and Russian relations?
Yes. Which, by the way, was all part of the plan. I don't think the DNC had any desire or designs on maintaining good relationships with Russia in any way, shape, or form. As I said, this is largely in part due to the fact that this particular administration of bumbling incompetents and lunatics have decided right from the get-go that Russia has been an existential threat to the American democracy, adopting a somewhat incredibly, it's like a massive hypocritical position where they're going, oh, Russia tried to interfere with our elections. By the way, the evidence for which is like Facebook pages and shit, as far as I can tell. No one tried to hack like voting machines or any of that stuff. And that's bad. You shouldn't fuck with other people's elections. Definitely not. Meanwhile, you're the fucking United States. You're the United States. There's not a free election that's happened on Earth without you cunts getting involved. What are you talking about? So you see the problem, right? And so obviously I don't think they give a fuck too much about wanting to have relationships with Russia. In fact, I would argue they would much rather have the Cold War based on everything they said while Trump was in power, and actually a little bit before it, going back to the annexation of Crimea.
Rupture right now in U.S.-Russian relations if they continue on this path that they're on. And in terms of Cold War, that depends. You have the vast majority of the rest of the world in total opposition to what he's doing, from Asia to South America to Europe to around the world. And so it's going to be a cold day for Russia. The idea, you don't see a whole lot of people coming to his defense.
And are you, if I could follow up, sir, are you urging China to help isolate Russia? Are you urging China to help isolate Russia?
I'm not prepared to comment on that at the moment.
Yeah, you're definitely not prepared to comment on what Big Daddy China's gonna do and what talks you've had. Because now you're in a fucking weird spot, aren't you? You're in a weird spot, Joe. Because let's also be real. The only way this conflict actually can stop now, if NATO aren't gonna put troops on the ground, these sanctions they'll hurt Russia long term as a power, which is why Biden's talking about let's revisit in a month or two down the line. You know, which is fucking crazy, right? Like, the sanctions are not going to immediately stop what Putin's doing. But, you know, if China were to lend their weight and be like, listen, all right, we're going to continue to do business with Kiev, but with Moscow, not so much. Probably not a position they would adopt, because obviously China just wants to make money and be the real superpower on the planet. You know, so you sort of are in this weird spot, Joe, where you need China to sort of come in and maybe give Russia a little tap on the shoulder. And let's be real, you've not positioned yourself particularly well with China, have you? So it's tough being president, mate. It's hard.
No. He's had his hand up a long time.
Thank you, Mr. President. How concerned are you that Putin wants to go beyond Ukraine into
question's already been asked as well.
Other countries and the U.S. will have to get involved if he moves into NATO countries.
Well, if he did move into NATO countries, he will be involved. We will be involved. The only thing that I'm convinced of is if we don't stop now, he'll be emboldened. If we don't move against him now with these significant sanctions, he will be emboldened.
Bring it back, Joe. Bring it back. Bring it back. If we don't move against him now, with sanctions, with sanctions. Yeah, that's right. We can't invade. It's not a Middle Eastern country.
Look, you know, every, well, anyway.
And can you talk anything more about your conversation? Can you,
Fuck off, intern. Fuck off with your squeaky voice and your shit question that's already been asked. Sit down. Sit down with your Primark suit, you cunt.
I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
So India, which is a major defense partner of the United States, is India fully with you on the issue of Ukraine and Russia?
Indian Times.
So is the Defense Department of the United States?
So India is one of your major defense partners.
It is.
Is India fully in sync with the United States on Russia?
We're going to be, we're in consultation with India today. We haven't resolved that completely.
One more question.
Actually, what's interesting is Pakistan have gone and met with Putin because of this. So Pakistan had a sit down with Putin literally just as I was going live. I don't know too much about what's been said or what's been agreed. Well, that's a fucking, that's something to watch. That's definitely something to watch out for as well as an interesting development. So,
okay, thank you all very much. Thank you.
My press colleagues certainly hungry for questions and answers and a lot, frankly, to go through here.
The president, it's all so wacky, isn't it? It's all so wacky. World War. It's all happening. Wackiness. Hungry for answers. So there you go. That was Joe Biden's speech from earlier. And as I said, not a particularly great one, as they very, very rarely. In fact, he's yet to deliver a great speech, I would say. Maybe that one where he said, if you don't vote on all the bills we put forward, you're partners with Confederate generals. Maybe that was his best speech, actually. It was certainly his most memorable. But yeah, let me just double check on that Pakistan thing that was breaking just as we went live. Yeah, so it says here, Pakistan's leader is in Moscow to meet with Putin about a gas pipeline. Well, guess they're all in then. Imran Khan. What a weird day Pakistan's had, right? Okay, check this. What a weird day for Imran Khan. He goes out to meet with Putin. This like something like 11, 12 hours ago that was announced. He goes out to meet Putin. You can see here. Yeah, he arrived at the Kremlin earlier today to meet President Vladimir Putin. Look at this. Right, man, I'll tell you one thing I just have to point out, right? One thing I just have to point out, because if you've never followed all of this stuff, I know people in the chat are buckled already. If you've never followed this stuff before, the Prime Minister's official, like, accounts on social media, whenever he has, like, a formal meeting, they do it like it's a fucking influencer video. It's fucking wild. It's wild. It's sort of interesting how everyone's approach to what's appropriate culturally is fucking so wildly different. But anyway, so the original plans to go out and discuss this gas pipeline, evidently, but now 4 hours after that, when pressed, he's kind of had to say, well, listen, yeah, you know, Russia pipelines, gas, it's all great, isn't it? But you know, the conflict's bad, like, it is bad. So just watch this. This is like, need some rain lashing down on my bare chest. Well, look. The time I met Putin in the middle of a war. So ridiculous, so kawaii. Unreal, isn't it? So anyway, so that was that. And then later on, you can see here, the Prime Minister stressed conflict's not in anyone's interest. Please, let's have the pipeline. Please don't fuck this. Please. It's not in anyone's interest, and that the developing countries were always hit hardest economically in case of conflict. He underlined Pakistan's belief that disputes should be resolved through dialogue and diplomacy and 80s rock solos. Expressing concerns on rising trends of extremism and Islamophobia in the world, the Prime Minister emphasized the need for interfaith harmony and coexistence. So that was an interesting day for Pakistan. That was kind of all just unfolding. So I didn't get much of a chance to look at that. Right then, let's do some American media. Let's do that, because I'm getting low energy now. Just before we do that, let's also cover this, because this is interesting. Right, Biden, again, I showed you this earlier in the stream. Biden has been sort of telling Americans for a while that you are going to feel this. Initially, it was, come on, man. Come on, Jack. International sanctions. Come on, man. I'm not trying to be a wise guy, but come on, man. And so, he was saying that, supply lines were breaking down and everything, and that was the real problem. And it definitely wasn't him or any of his policies or Build Back Better or printing more money or emboldening Putin by creating a negative relationship that now OPEC are eyeing up, or were. I don't know what this does to that, but, OPEC were kind of open to, ooh, maybe Putin. Finally, Russia can join OPEC and we can have him in our cartel. That was going on. And then now, as of like 2 days ago, no, it was all about Ukraine the whole time. The inflation's all about Ukraine the whole time. The reason everything's so expensive, Ukraine. Reason so everything's so expensive, Russia and Ukraine. But just to put it in context as to how bad things are going to get, check this out. This is from Joe Concho, who's a columnist, works at The Hill. Dow futures are down more than 800. Crude oil tops $100 a barrel. Most Americans will now feel the pain of $6 to $7 per gallon of gas. And after witnessing what unfolded in Afghanistan and now in Ukraine, they will come to the logical conclusion about the current president and this administration. Now, listen, that seems to be unthinkable that it could get that bad. But you have to remember, it's been creeping back up towards $4 again prior to this issue. And yes, along with the collapse of the Russian stock market, along with the crash of the ruble, other significant financial impact globally that's being felt is that, yes, all oil, gas, whatever you want to call it, that's all crude, basically. It's all up across the board, and it is going to impact on everyone's energy prices, everyone's petrol prices, gas prices, depending on your region. So, yes, it's bad. It is bad. It's and like I say, no matter where you are in the world, you will feel some aftershock effect of this. But not to worry. Obviously, economic stuff like that is certainly comparatively mild to what's happening in the Ukraine. That goes without saying. Right, media. Here's what I'm going to start with. And it might surprise you. Because as you know, our guy, based and red-pilled Tucker Carlson, man who, what was it, that they based the Division 2 on, I don't even know where this is going. He really had a fucking take that aged like fucking milk. I mean, it is so staggeringly bad. It was bad at the time, but like what's happened within 24 hours of this airing is just awful. So let's laugh at this.
Good evening and welcome to Tucker Carlson Tonight.
I'll probably get banned for playing Tucker Carlson on Twitch, won't I? Such are the times, but whatever.
Since the day that Donald Trump became president, Democrats in Washington have told you have a patriotic duty to hate Vladimir Putin. It's not a suggestion, it's a mandate. Anything less than hatred for Putin is treason.
Now, I want to be clear. I don't like wars. Don't like them at all. And I don't think, as a rule, you should interfere with nations and, kill tyrannical leaders and sort of try and police the world. But I'll also just throw this out there. I do hate Vladimir Putin. I really do. I think he's an arsehole. I always thought he was an arsehole. Just putting that out there. But yes, this monologue he's about to deliver is aged. Like, I don't think I've seen anything age so badly, so quickly, for a long time in the American media landscape.
Many Americans have obeyed this directive. They now dutifully hate Vladimir Putin. Maybe you're one of them. Hating Putin has become the central purpose of America's foreign policy. It's the main thing that we talk about. Entire cable channels are now devoted to it. Very soon, that hatred of Vladimir Putin could bring the United States into a conflict in Eastern Europe. Before that happens, it might be worth asking yourself, since it is getting pretty serious, what is this really about? Why do I hate Putin so much? Has Putin ever called me a racist? Has he threatened to get me fired for disagreeing with him? Has he shipped every middle-class job in my town to Russia? Did he manufacture a worldwide pandemic that wrecked my business and kept me indoors for 2 years? Is he teaching my children to embrace racial discrimination? Is he making fentanyl? Is he trying to snuff out Christianity? Does he eat dogs?
Yeah. There's just no there's no way you can sort of like bring any of that back from the just, it's over the cliff of just staggeringly awful opinions. You know, does he kill journalists? You know, these are questions. Does he kill journalists? Does he oppress his people? Does he suppress human rights? Does he criminalize gay people? You know, these are the types of questions I ask, not does he eat dogs? Whatever the implication is, that am I supposed to hate people who do? I don't know what, I don't really know where you're going with this, Tucky. You're off the fucking reservation, homie.
These are fair questions, and the answer to all of them is...
Someone in the chat has gone, does he watch anime? Does he own a fursuit? Those would also be perfectly valid questions.
No, Vladimir Putin didn't do any of that. So why does permanent Washington hate him so much? If you've been watching the news, you know that Putin is having a border dispute with a nation called Ukraine. Now, the main thing to know about Ukraine for our purposes is that its leaders once sent millions of dollars to Joe Biden's family. Not surprisingly, Ukraine is now one of Biden's favorite countries. Biden has pledged to defend Ukraine's borders even as he opens our borders to the world. That's how.
Now, and look, I avoided kind of wading into all of that stuff. There are definite questions around the Biden family, Zelensky, energy companies in Ukraine, self-enrichment, selling of the office, the laptop story that was suppressed. There's a lot to unpack. Sorry, that's very shit-lib thing to say. This, absolutely nothing to do with it. The United States, you know, yes, they have deliberately eroded Russian relationships. Yes, they've done that predicated on an absolute fantasy that Vladimir Putin got Trump elected and that, you know, they made Russia an existential enemy when they absolutely didn't have to. But this is absolutely about preserving the integrity of NATO. This conflict is essentially about, you know, and this is where it gets kind of a tricky issue to negotiate, because if you're not willing to defend an ally as NATO, then what's the point in being an ally to NATO? And if you will only defend the members of NATO, well, why don't you fast-track membership into NATO? But it is about essentially preserving the strength of NATO, which, by the way, in terms of its economic size, stability, it's a very powerful block of nations, and it's absolutely necessary in a world that otherwise would be dominated by Russia and China, and perhaps even increasingly India. As we move forward, fast forward 20, 25 years, we'll probably get into a lot of these types of global conflicts when India wants to have their time in the sun as they continue to develop technology, produce billionaires, expand their businesses, and have a populace that has an increased quality of living, that has a genuine thirst for all of the things that we've enjoyed with impunity in the West for a long, long time. So the inference that Biden is doing this out of some sort of loyalty to a country because it gave his family money is an absolutely insanely poor reading of what's going on. And I mean, it doesn't surprise me, because in the same monologue, he's implied that you should dislike people for eating dogs. I don't really know. It's mad.
It works. Invading America is called equity. Invading Ukraine is a war crime. So with every day, we move closer to some kind of conflict with Russia, conflict that could easily spin out of control, given that the people running this have no fine motor skills. The administration assures us this has nothing at all to do with repaying Joe Biden's personal debts to Ukrainian oligarchs. Not at all. It's completely and totally unrelated. The point here is to defend democracy. Not that Ukraine is a democracy. It is not a democracy. Ukraine's president has arrested his main political opponent. He has shut down newspapers and television stations that have dared to criticize him. So in American terms, you would call Ukraine a tyranny. But Joe Biden likes Ukraine, so Putin bad, war good. How will this...
And again, listen, yeah, Ukraine's definitely engaged in some of that. And obviously, as I showed you earlier with the kind of media coverage that's been going on, yeah, they've had some issues with white nationalist groups acting on behalf of the state for the purposes of defense from Russia and probably other things besides that we don't know about. But again, it's a complicated landscape. And there is certainly no question, if you were to ask me, as just a layperson in this, who is a greater sort of threat to world harmony, world peace? Is it Zelensky's Ukraine or Putin's Russia? Well, it's a fucking complete no-brainer. And again, remember, it's not just the Biden administration that was doing this. It wasn't like Trump got together and said, you know, fucking absolutely not, we can't have Ukraine join NATO. There was no insistence that didn't go ahead when Trump was in charge. I don't really get the angle that this is like actually Joe Biden repaying his debts to Ukraine. It seems absolutely farcical to sort of say it with a straight face on cable news.
Conflict affect you? Will affect you quite a bit, actually. Energy prices in the United States are about to go way up, and that means that everything you buy will become much more expensive. From the food you eat, to the car you drive, to tickets you need to take your family on vacation this summer, assuming you can still afford vacation by then. You're about to become measurably poor. That's not a guess. Joe Biden has admitted this. On the other hand, you're going to win an important moral victory against dastardly old Vladimir Putin, who is much, much worse than Justin Trudeau, just so you know. So you can feel good about that, because...
And again, listen, I didn't like how Justin Trudeau handled the fucking Freedom Convoy, and I don't like Trudeau much. He's a greasy little weasel of an authoritarian that does it under the code of benevolence. I don't like those people. But again, a comparison between Trudeau and Putin is outrageous. These people do not measure up to each other in any way, shape, or form in terms of global threat. Let me know when fucking Trudeau is invading a neighboring nation. Like, let me know when that happens, right?
Because, let's see, come to think of it, why would you feel good about that? It seems like a pretty terrible deal for you and for the United States. Hunter Biden gets $1 million a year from Ukraine, but you can no longer afford to go out to dinner. That's not a bargain. So what are we missing here? What we're missing is the big picture. And that's why Joe Biden has dispatched Kamala Harris to explain that picture to us. Kamala Harris's old job was to open America's borders. She did that. Her new job is to keep Ukraine's borders closed. Kamala Harris was in Europe the other day to explain the whole thing. She began with a history lesson, letting the European peoples know about their recent past, which she assumes they've forgotten since so few of them speak English. She opened with the traditional salutation, "Listen, guys," because that's the way real historians and...
Now, I will just add, this monologue, as I said, has aged terribly, and it's nonsense and gibberish, and it's one of Tucker Carlson's top five worst ever. But Kamala Harris is a fucking mess. Let's just be real. She's incompetent. She shouldn't be the vice president. She's absolutely... not qualified for that job, which is terrifying because Biden's not qualified to be president either. And, you know, just, I think if I remember this rightly, he does show footage of it and it is bad.
The states people talk. Watch Kamala educate.
I mean, listen, guys, we're talking.
Wearing a mask has been actually good for Kamala because you can't see that awful fake mannequin smile. And when she cackles like a witch, like she likes to do, that fake laugh that she puts on to try and humanize herself, the mask kind of like muffles that, like, that fucking Wicked Witch of the East energy. So I don't know if, like, maybe there's like some guy, some strategy going, like, Kamala, not only is it good optics to wear the mask because of COVID, but actually your approval's going up. Keep going with the mask. Keep going with the mask.
Potential for war in Europe. I mean, let's really take a moment to understand the significance of what we're talking about. It's been over 70 years. And through those 70 years, as I mentioned yesterday, there has been peace and security.
In Europe, but not actually at all, in fact. you know, do seem to remember the Croatian situation a little bit. you know, where it was a bit the Croat Serbian, you know, collapse of Yugoslavia and Croat Serbian Bosnian. Yeah, we you know, peace and prosperity though, nothing to worry about. Nothing to worry about. Turkey, Cyprus, yeah, you know.
We are talking about the real possibility of war in Europe.
Listen, guys, you may be Europeans who live in Europe, but you don't fully understand the ramifications of war in Europe. That's
yeah, don't worry, though, Tucker, it's fine. We are used to Americans explaining the rest of how the world works to us, older nations. That includes you over at Fox News, doesn't it? So, you know, it's fine. Thanks for the concern.
It's your problem. The thing about Europe, you've had peace and security for more than 70 years. Kamala Harris just told the Europeans that. And that, by the way, is true if you don't count the breakup of Yugoslavia, which caused hundreds of thousands of deaths in the 1990s, or the Soviet occupation of half of the landmass, which amounted to the enslavement of hundreds of millions. But apart from that, Mrs. Lincoln, it's all been peace and security in Europe until now. Now, the Soviets were fine. Vladimir Putin is bad. What do we do about that? Kamala Harris explained that too. Watch.
And the allied relationship is such that we have agreed that the deterrence effect of these sanctions is still a meaningful one, especially because, remember also, we still sincerely hope that there is a diplomatic path out of this moment. And within the context then of the fact that that window is still opening, although it is absolutely narrowing, but within the context of a diplomatic path still being open, the deterrence effect, we believe, has merit.
Now, remember, we've just seen a speech, haven't we, from today of Joe Biden saying, we always knew that the sanctions would be absolutely no deterrent whatsoever. So which is it? Like, which is it? And mate, this administration just pivots from one thing to the other. It just, I mean, if the media class in the US just weren't asleep at the wheel, you could fucking sting these guys over and over again. Lies literally 24 hours apart. It's madness. It's madness. Just an incoherent jabbering of how they're really in control, even though anyone with half a brain can see this is all unraveling. You know, this is not a US that's in charge of anything at all at the moment. It's a fucking shit show.
Got that? Take a breath and let it sink in. Here it is again. Quote, we have agreed that the deterrence effect of these sanctions is still a meaningful one, especially because, remember also, we still sincerely hope that there is a diplomatic path out of this moment. And within the context then of the fact that the window is still open, although it is absolutely narrowing, but within the context of a diplomatic path still being open, the deterrence effect, we believe, has merit. Well, of course it has merit. The only question is, what the hell are you talking about? And the answer is Kamala Harris has no real idea what she's talking about. She can't even point to the direction of what she's talking about. Her mouth opens and predigested chunks of language come tumbling out in no particular order. It's soothing to listen to until you try to understand what it means. As Kamala Harris told us just last month, quote, it is time for us to do what we have been doing. And that time is every day.
I remember when she went for that soundbite. Oh my God. It's like, you know, she wanted her little iconic moment. That quote is just staggering. Like, just try and think, but just try and process it. Just try and process it.
To which we'd respond, that's right, Ms. Vice President Person. Today is the first day of the rest of your life. Learn it, love it, live it. And while you're at it, eat, pray, love.
Not dog, though.
Vladimir Putin's reaction to all of this, when an aide drops a translated transcript of Kamala Harris's remarks on his desk, the Slavic mind is a hall of mirrors. It sees traps at every intersection. Clearly, Kamala Harris must be setting some sort of trap for the Russians here. Her words don't make sense, but she can't possibly be dim and childish. America is a superpower. It would never put a senile man and an imbecile in charge of the country.
So yeah, no, all right, he pulled it back at the end. No, absolutely staggeringly awful take, and that's a 6-minute segment from a much longer 14-minute bit, because he does get back to the whole Putin thing and talking about how, like, you know, Americans shouldn't have a problem with Putin. You absolutely should. Yeah, just in case you're under sort of any illusions about which way Tucker blows on this particular issue, Here he is here. This is from 2019. He makes it abundantly clear how he feels about it should this conflict escalate in future. And here it is.
Going on in the conflict between Ukraine and Russia. Because, and I'm serious. Like, why do I care?
Why.
And why shouldn't I root for Russia, because, which I am?
Because those of us who are watching...
What's going on in the conflict between Ukraine and Russia? Because, and I'm serious. Like, why do
I'll
care?
Tell you why.
And why shouldn't I root for Russia,
because,
which I am?
Because...
It's kind of a yikes. That's kind of a big yikes, isn't it? So there you go. So just in case you're wondering which way he's blowing on it and why his fucking take is so stupefyingly bad and ill-informed, he sort of made up his mind a while ago, didn't he? Right, now, while we also talk about figures that usually have good takes, figures, well, I say, I'm not saying he usually has good takes, but it's just, but, you know, not staggeringly bad takes, let's say. Tulsi Gabbard did an absolute fucking howler today as well. I was like, I couldn't believe it. And listen, she's trying to add some nuance, but again, the way it's worded is shockingly awful. You can see this war and suffering could have easily been avoided if the Biden administration and NATO had simply acknowledged Russia's legitimate security concerns regarding Ukraine's becoming a member of NATO, which would mean US NATO forces right on Russia's border. Now, when you say legitimate security concerns, that's a very loaded statement. You're trying to do a lot of heavy lifting with the premise. Yes, I've told you today, certainly if NATO came out and said, don't worry, Vladimir, Ukraine will never be a member of NATO while you're alive, he probably takes his foot off the accelerator and we don't have a war right now. Same as if US had sort of said, look, okay, we'll ask them to defer it, or we won't vote for Ukraine to become a member, instead of making Russia the old enemy and taking us back to the fucking 80s. But those things didn't happen. And so obviously that's how we get to where we are. But to imply that there's a legitimate security concern implies what Vladimir Putin himself was saying, which was he feared that Ukraine would invade Russia, which is absolute nonsense. Of course they wouldn't. You only have to look at the fucking landmass difference to realize the grotesque impracticalities of that particular venture. And on top of that, it also implies that NATO would go against all the international laws and conventions and treaties and agreements they've signed up to and wage an aggressive war in Russia, of all countries, to start off? No. So to call the security concerns legitimate is ridiculous. To say you could have framed this as, you know, Putin didn't want a NATO nation on his border, although that doesn't even really hold up, because if you look at it, there are others. To me, just an awful, awful message. Now, what ended up happening off the back of that, because Tulsi, if you remember, she did serve in the American military, lots of people started to threaten her and call her a traitor. Just before as well, we get into the harrowing world of dog shit American opinions. Let me just remind you of this, because this is sort of a stark contrast to the outrageous Biden sycophancy we've seen. Now, obviously, where it was always clear to me, Donald Trump was indeed actually in charge of his own Twitter. I knew that the moment Covfefe fucking happened, right? Joe Biden clearly isn't. Like, he can't do the things needed to log into a Twitter account, type a tweet, and put it out there publicly. Like, he clearly doesn't have the fucking mechanisms at work, at play, right? But whoever wrote this, this is when, of course, in 2020, we're on the campaign trail, you know? Vladimir Putin doesn't want me to be president. He doesn't want me to be our nominee. If you're wondering why, it's because I'm the only person in this field who's ever gone toe-to-toe with him. Now, you guys watching now might not have watched the earlier stream, but just to clarify, he has met Vladimir Putin once. He's met him once, and it was in 2011. So a long time before all this shit started happening, years before even the initial uprising to overthrow the Ukrainian president that was a puppet of Moscow, that got us Poroshenko. And that was when, of course, Joe Biden tells that ridiculous story where he says, you know, I looked into his eyes and said, you have no soul. And Putin said, we understand one another. Which, by the way, would be a straight fire scene in a movie. But Joe Biden, all of his anecdotes are from a movie. Corn Pop, and how he fucking chased down Corn Pop to save a local swimming pool. Isn't that Goonies too? Like, what is this cunt on about? He is bananas. He's absolutely bananas. Like, he just makes shit up all the time. Like, when he claimed to be a top student and graduated, like, cum laude and all this stuff, and it all turned out to be bullshit, and he was barely functional. He's just, the guy's a mess. But that's what he said, and this is what we've got. So, remember that, right? Because you're going to see some shit. Stephen King, he's just a fiction writer, isn't he? Just a fiction writer. Just a man who has written about everything ever. Including, by the way, having some, like, pretty... If you know about the sewer scene in It, then, he's had some issues. Mr. Putin has made a serious miscalculation. He forgot he's no longer dealing with Trump. This was 24 hours before the invasion. And yeah, turns out he is no longer dealing with Trump, and we have a ground invasion in the Ukraine. What else have we got? Joe Lockhart, and this was 2 days ago. Now, keep in mind, you've just watched just a disastrous press conference, all the ones from Joe Biden. Whatever happens in Ukraine, we shouldn't underestimate the fact the United States has retaken the adult chair in the world. This is Joe Lockhart, CNN political analyst. Biden has restored American leadership so damaged by Trump. The world needs us, and we have a president who can and does lead. And then he said, sometimes the best way to expose ignorance is just letting people talk. No, but Biden's crushing it, guys. Thought this was a bit of a mental one worth talking about. I've probably told you about Lawrence Tribe. He often pops up in episodes of Enemy of the People because he's just a fucking lunatic. He's one of these guys who's absolutely all in, on this idea about this imaginary coup d'etat that happened. And he tweets all day, every day. He is a professor of law who graduated from Harvard. And it's just sad. And he has over 1 million followers. And people actually take him as an authoritative source on legal matters and political information. Unfortunately, he's just deranged. As this from the 21st demonstrates, where he said, led by Fox News Channel's Tucker Carlson, the GOP's Trump wing appears to be throwing its weight behind Putin. If Putin opts to wage war on our ally Ukraine, such aid and comfort to an enemy would appear to become treason as defined by Article 3 of the US Constitution. Now listen, that's not true. That's not true in any way, shape or form. He talks about treason a lot. Because, as I said, he's obsessed with January 6th. Everything's treason to him. But in reality, pretty high bar for that crime. Right, let's get into... Oh, no, wait, before we do that as well. How about this for a staggeringly poor taste move from Seth Abramson. Now, he's a New York Times best-selling author. He's written in a number of major publications. He's popped up a bunch in political content I've made. He thought now would be the perfect time to plug his book. This is 24 hours before the invasion happened. It was right on the cusp of it. Oh, no, sorry. It was just as it happened, actually. My bad. Putin is shelling Kiev. I'm an author, not a soldier, so I can only urge folks to borrow the book below from a friend library or purchase it if you have the means to do so. This book was my effort to warn America about the sort of thing we're seeing on TV now. In the book, there is proof of corruption, bribery, impeachment, and pandemic in the age of Trump. So in other words, absolutely fuck all to do with the... border tensions between Ukraine and Russia. He did delete that, to his credit. But, he's having a normal one. after getting absolutely slammed for using a war to plug a book. You can see he tweets things out now and he sets it so only people he follows can reply. And you can see, I don't believe Tucker Carlson is a paid Kremlin agent seeking to destabilize the United States from the inside. I'm saying that he'd be acting and speaking exactly the way he is right now if he were. It's a classic. It's a classic. Just a couple of, you know, just normal, regular, everyday folk that you might see. This is the contributing editor of the Black Agenda Report, co-host of Left Lens, and co-editor of Friends of Socialist China. So a lot of really weighty publications there. Turns out denazifying the Ukraine is a good thing, actually. A native tanky. People said, Richard, you're wrong. There's no tanky supporting a Russian. Oh, they're all over the place, mate. They're all over the place. There it is. Danny Haifong. Check him out. And then, of course, when this tweet blew up for being staggeringly bad, he did the old, this did numbers. Ha, check out my SoundCloud. Here's my Patreon. Unbelievable. Kate Mann. Oh, don't. You deleted it, you silly sausage. Why would you do that? There you go. There it is. Kate Mann, writer and philosopher at Cornell, had a good one, had a good take. The real problem in this difficult geopolitical climate, it's toxic masculinity, and it's going to kill us all. That's what's really going on. It's Putin's toxic masculinity forcing him to do this. There were several other replies to this where she was like trying to sort of like, you know, dig herself out of the getting dunked on hole. I'll just say this. I hope Ukraine have got a few toxic men to, you know, maybe resist what's happening there on the ground. You know, maybe you'll enjoy this one, guys. It is a hood classic. Putin is invading Ukraine in a fit of megalomania and a desperate bid to stay in power. Trump invaded our capital in a fit of megalomania and a desperate bid to stay in power. Two genocidal maniacs who think nothing of slaughtering countless innocents to satisfy their own ambitions. Now listen, I was there on January 6th. Well, not there, I better not say that. I'm on a fucking list now, aren't I? I was there on January 6th. Ladies and gentlemen, we got him. No, I mean, I was there on the internet when it happened, right? And I was watching it, and I don't remember the genocide. I don't remember the genocide. I missed. If somebody can link me, I'd like to get brought up to speed. And she goes on to say, Jesus fucking Christ, or of course, you know, JFC, because you can't curse if you're woke. I think Vladimir Putin is threatening nuclear war. This is the lunatic the GOP is praising, which is interesting because, let me get this. Even according to definitely not biased NPR, right? Republicans are condemning Putin for the invasion of Ukraine. They're not praising Putin. Now, Tucker Carlson, mate. Tucker Carlson's not. I hate to break it to everyone. Tucker Carlson isn't in the GOP, is he? He might be one day. We'll talk about that then. But you've got to stop watching Fox News, guys. Like, you can't just watch Fox News. Tucker Carlson does not speak for the GOP directly, does he? But yeah, there have been a number of people have come out. Mitch McConnell obviously came out. He criticized both Putin and the sanctions. Been a number of people in the GOP that have said it's not acceptable. I'm sure DeSantis is having a presidential moment somewhere talking about it. Just putting that out there. Reality, who cares? Reality facts, who cares? Who cares? You'll enjoy this one, guys, I'm sure. Draft the unvaccinated. This was a direct reply to the President of the United States decrying the loss of life and human suffering. Draft the unvaccinated, said Angela Belcamino, who has in her bio, hashtag was blocked by Trump. Reasonable. And of course, what's particularly fucking funny about this It's a staggeringly bad and stupid thing to say. But at the start, the month started with an announcement that unvaccinated soldiers would be fucking discharged from service. These shit libs and they're fucking like, you morons, you fucking DNC acolyte morons. Well, yeah, we should have the unvaccinated in the army because they don't deserve to live because they're unvaccinated and they don't value human life because they're unvaccinated. So let's send them to a foreign war to die. That'll show them for being unvaccinated. But actually, we can't have unvaccinated people in the army. What does it say about us as men? Fucking pick one, you morons. Fucking pick one, you stupid cunts. How hard is it to just pick one? You know, the idea, by the way, of all the fucking places you're going to fire people for being fucking unvaccinated, the US military, yeah, we couldn't, there's a risk you might spread COVID. Now, shut the fuck up and get in that minefield, you cunt. We need the oil, we need the opium. Like, what are you talking about? It's the last of their fucking worries, you maniacs. You know, I remember seeing an article. In fact, let me just show you what this DNC is on a par with. And this is obviously a CIA planted story. It's not real, but this is how stupid it is. You're now as stupid as this article, which when I saw the headline at the time on my timeline, I went, oh, the onion's back, baby. And then it wasn't the onion, right? ISIS tells followers not to travel to Europe for attacks because of outbreak. The healthy should not enter the land of the epidemic, says the terrorist group. So listen, I'm saying it's real. That has to be a CIA planted. Sorry, that's got to be US media disinfo. There's no way. Someone at ISIS actually said, come in. Are you ready for the suicide bombing? And like the guy's gone, yes, we will travel to Paris tomorrow and do the bombing. And then like, he's like, have you been vaccinated? Do you have your vaccine passport? It's like, for fuck, there's no fucking way any of that's happening, for fuck's sake. Well, you don't want to catch a cough, brother. What will happen then? What will happen to jihad? Like, it's fucking, there's no way any of that's happening. It's so mental that, like, you're telling me that, like, these people that fucking tell suicide bombers to go fucking kill people. It's like, listen, this is no laughing matter. You know, it's worse than a flu. It's worse than a flu. You know, like, that isn't real. But the point is, the US military are putting themselves in all these, like, fucking insane, you know, fucking, they're putting all these insane, dangerous situations. And we're just like, yeah, you might spread the coup, so you've got to be fired. By the way, if you get your vaccine, we will also put you in the fucking, you know, go look up Gulf War Syndrome. Yes, the health of our troops is absolutely paramount. Now, let us inject you with a bunch of fucking wacky serums and drugs, and then make you sign papers so you can't tell anyone what you've been injected with. Like, fuck all of this shit. Fuck this insanity. But yeah, draft the unvaccinated. Also, I know I opened up with a fucking clip of today's war, sponsored by Applebee's. Get three entrees for $12 at your local. Right, it opened up with that shit, right? Fucking make it stop. This is like the Dave Chappelle Ja Rule fucking sketch. It's, can you get Ja Rule? Like, Cardi B says she's not really on NATO or Russia's side. Well, all right then. I'm in. I'm in on this. Like, what does Cardi B have to fucking say about this situation? Rachel Maddow, everyone's favorite Harry Potter cosplayer. She's been on the blog. You know what really is going on, guys? You know why this is all really happening? Trump. It was Trump. Why didn't Russia invade Ukraine during Trump's term? Right? Why? Well, they've got the answer. Perhaps because Putin was so pleased to see Trump pursuing goals in line with Moscow's agenda. So, wait, right? So, I mean, I'm gonna try, Rachel. All right, I'm gonna try. Remember when you ran those fake pictures? No, okay. It's all right. No, I'm gonna try. Right. So the invasion didn't happen when Trump was there, when Trump was a Russian asset, because Putin didn't need to do it when he would have had an asset as the ally of a major member of NATO. So he waited for Trump to get voted out until a US hostile administration happened, and then decided to invade at a time when he would see worse sanctions and worse reprisals. Perfect. You nailed it. Nailed it. Yeah, you've got that. 10-dimensional Jenga just being played there. Holy fucking shit. This isn't even anything to do with anything. But mate, this is again, this, imagine platforming this nonsense. Jake Tapper, right, tweeted out, former President George W. Bush condemns Russia's attack. Oh, really? I would love to hear the thoughts of a fucking war criminal. Anyone else? Shall I get my fucking Ouija board out and call what Pol Pot fucking has to say about it? George W. Bush condemns Russia attack. The world condemned the invasion of Iraq. And you sat there smirking about it. And you had the journalist who threw a fucking shoe at you in prison. Here he is. I used to be able to do a wicked George Bush impersonation, but I can't do it no more. I just can't. It's gone. It used to be something I could do on command. I can't do it now. Russia's attack on... It doesn't sound like that. Actually, that's me. Russia's attack on Ukraine constitutes the gravest security crisis on the European continent since World War II. I joined the international community. Like, no one gives a fuck, mate. You're just some cunt who got away with some of the most heinous international acts that any world leader has done. You also did all sorts of heinous shit to your own populace, which, by the way, is all just still there. You know, the fucking, the NSA, totally fine. Patriot Act, fine. What does Ja Rule have to say about it? It's crazy. Anyway, I joined the international community condemning Vladimir Putin's unprovoked and unjustified invasion of Ukraine. Yeah, those unprovoked and unjustified invasions really do suck, don't they? They really do suck. Not a single Iraqi involved in 9/11. Very dubious evidence, including discredited intelligence and a strange paper document that survived in the wreckage. Crazy. Unprovoked and unjustified invasion of Ukraine. The American must stand in solidarity with Ukraine and the Ukrainian people as they seek freedom and the right to choose their own future. We cannot tolerate authoritarian bullying and the danger that Putin poses. Ukraine is our friend and democratic ally and deserves our full support during this most difficult time. Staggering, isn't it? Absolutely staggering. John Harwood, John J. Harwood. This is the White House correspondent for CNN, by the way. A hilarious sort of title, the more and more you think about it. What did he have to say? Why is this happening? Why? Right, why is this happening? Garrett M. Graff, who is a journalist and historian who has contributed to lofty publications like Wired and CNN, said, one thing worth keeping in my mind today, there's a straight line, from Russia's attacks on the US election in 2016 to January the 6th to today's invasion of Ukraine. Now listen, guys, I'm smart. If anyone can draw me that fucking line, the only consistency in it is the media lied about all of it the entire time. I mean, I can follow that line. The chaos that Russia unleashed with the election of Trump, read that back. The chaos that Russia unleashed with the election of Trump, we're really doubling down on that line. Weakened us to the point Putin feels confident invading Europe. And then John Harwood, again, remember, White House correspondent for CNN, or CNN correspondent for the White House. You know, it's interchangeable in many ways. Another way of stating Garrett's point, the Russian thug now attacking Ukraine helped Donald Trump become president because he thought that would someday make this kind of attack easier to pull off. He was right in the short term, longer term to be decided. So again, remember, 10-dimensional Jenga going on, 10-dimensional Jenga, that what happened was Putin put Trump in for 4 years, did nothing the entire time, waited for him to get voted out, didn't help, didn't rig that election, right? Didn't rig the second election, the crucial election, in many ways. Then waited for Biden to get his feet under the table. Then did this because Trump. Brilliant. Fuck me. These are the people telling you the... Well, performing the news. These are the people that are giving the vast majority of America the facts of the matter. It is mental. This is why you can't... These people are fucking compromised across the board. They are lunatics. Let me just show you, right? I'm old enough to remember when the politics subreddit on politics wasn't taken over by Clintonites and became an astroturfed shithole courtesy of fucking ShareBlue and Correct the Record. Think about what's happening in the world, right? Keep it in mind who's in charge, all of the major players and all the geopolitical stuff I've talked about, all the history we've talked about with Russia and Ukraine. Let's just have a look at the politics subreddit and see if you can spot a common theme. It's still like this. Top thread. Bernie Sanders says Trump's praise for Putin's murderous invasion of Ukraine is outrageous. Now, you remember I told you what he said, but just in case you forgot, because it's an information dump, I'll play that before I get off tonight. White House spokesman calls Trump and Putin pigs who hate what America stands for. Fox News host corrects Trump when he says US troops, not Russians, landed in Ukraine. I mean, okay. I guess when someone misspeaks, it's really bad, isn't it? It's really bad when people get their words mixed up. I just watched a press conference where your guy shouted the word yes at a random interval when being asked if America would fucking put troops on the ground in Ukraine. Trump continues to praise Putin, forcing GOP to fall in line or splinter from former president. McMaster breaks with Trump. Putin is certainly not someone to be praised. Trump immediately botches what's happening in Ukraine. Jen Psaki slams Donald Trump's effusive praise of Vladimir Putin. Fox News cuts off Donald Trump's insane rant about Ukraine's invasion and rigged 2020 election. Just a repeat of the Sanders headline at the bottom. So you can see strong uptake for this outrageous praise of Trump. And I agree, if Trump was praising Putin and saying what he's doing is good, I'd totally agree. Let me get the tape.
I said, this is genius. Putin declares a big portion of the Ukraine. Putin declares it as independent. Oh, that's wonderful. So Putin is now saying it's independent, a large section of Ukraine. I said, how smart is that? And he's going to go in and be a peacekeeper. That's the strongest peace force. We could use that on our southern border. That's the strongest peace force I've ever seen. There were more army tanks than I've ever seen. They're going to keep peace all right.
So the idea, by the way, that what he's saying there is what Putin is doing is fucking, like, good, is a fucking stretch and a very sort of I use the word uncharitable, but it's American politics, so what else are you going to do? Now, I will add, I don't know why he immediately goes off on a... I do know why he goes off on a fucking tangent, starts babbling about the southern border, because obviously he's fucking talking about re-election. And by the way, spoiler, he will not be allowed to run for office. I don't know why he's wasting his fucking time. And I don't know why the GOP are continuing to associate with him or recognize him as some sort of unofficial leader. It's all very strange. But yeah, for me, you'll notice the focus was on him praising Putin, which he didn't do. There's a couple of lines before that where he's saying, like, about how this wouldn't have happened if he was still in charge and yada, yada, yada. And basically, he says Putin's savvy, right? Which is the same as, again, calling him a worthy adversary, because he set up a paradigm where to the Russian people, he can appear like he's a peacekeeper. The southern border stuff's just fucking insane, reprehensible. Like, what, you want to send tanks to the fucking southern border? Like, what the fuck are you talking about? Been a cavalcade of just terrible opinions and nonsense and politicians trying to appeal to their base. In fact, actually, while we're still here, because I know people go, oh, Richard, why do you never go after the right wing? I think I've done that quite a bit today, actually. Let me get you some more dog shit American opinions while we're here. What grotesque political clamoring from the Trumpites as well. Like, this is fucking just so poor taste. This is nearly, it's worse probably than trying to sell a book, maybe. I don't know. Innocent Ukrainian civilians scared for their lives are calling out for the return of Donald J. Trump to the White House. No citation, no sourcing, no video, no nothing. This is Nick Adams, a founder and president of One Flag USA. No, they're not. This isn't happening. There is not a single fucking person who fears for their lives right now who is in a fucking shelled building going, oh, I wish Donald Trump was in the White House. Shut the fuck up. What? This is gross. This is fucking absolutely fucking awful. And it just shows you, man, like the in their minds, it's all about them. Every crisis, all about them. Doesn't matter what political party, all about them. Americans, you know, American-centric thinking. It's all about them. Trump would save us. Ridiculous. I'll show you some more staggeringly bad takes, and then we'll do the China thing, and then I think we're all up to speed for the day. Yes, here's one CNN opinion piece by SE Cup, I think. Oh, yeah, it was on their show Unfiltered. Again, day before the invasion. They identified the real people driving the invasion of Ukraine. In the latest episode of Unfiltered, SE Cup argues that as Russia prepares to invade neighboring Ukraine, Vladimir Putin is getting a huge boost from a somewhat unexpected corner of the world. America. The American far right, to be exact. Can anyone explain to me what power structure the far right have in America that could lend assistance, allyship, influence, and resources to Vladimir fucking Putin as he invades Ukraine? Anybody. Anybody. And I do agree, Unfiltered is a good name for a podcast. Can anybody tell me how the American far right is in any way playing a major role in any of this? Absolute fucking gibberish. We will continue to talk about the things we want to talk about and only talk about and exclusively talk about ad nauseum forever. It is the same pathetic political shell game no matter what is going on around the world. It is the American way. It is as American as apple fucking pie. I haven't even shown you the best one. Oh, I nearly forgot. Right, this is going to take some scrolling. He's another terminally online American. Here it is. Right. Now, if you know Peter Dow, I think that's how it's pronounced. Peter Dow is a guy who works for like, he founded Direct Left. He's been, he was one of those insufferable DNC pack voices when Hillary was running, and again when Biden was running. One of these people that whatever the DNC talking point of the day was, he'd be like, can I get some retweets up in this bitch, yeah? Can I get some retweets? Trump is Putin's puppet. Can I get some retweets? Anyone got some retweets? He's one of those, right? On Twitter, every fucking day, he got these people elected. He worked tirelessly to get these people elected. He smeared the Trump administration and every Republican who ever existed to ensure that we have the administration we have now. This motherfucker had the nerve to tweet this today. I was Jake Sullivan's colleague at the Clinton campaign, and I know half the senior people around Biden and Harris, and I'm concerned as fuck tonight. Interpret that as you will. I'm not trying to be cagey. I don't trust these people to handle a crisis like this. You put them in! You put them in! You worked to put them in! Holy shit, you can't just say that. Oh yeah, well I didn't know it was going to be a fucking like international crisis. You elect people to deal with that. And then he has the nerve to say, I'll also speak the truth about Democrats. You've been lying for fucking 8 years. Almost. It's longer probably, I can't. So yeah, I nearly forgot that. It was also this as well. You have to go back a little bit. This is 4 days old, so obviously a lot can happen in 4 days, especially in the current fucking news cycle. Just thought this was funny. Former US ambassador to NATO, Ivo Dalda, right, on how the Biden-Harris administration has handled Putin's saber-rattling in Ukraine. It's been a class in diplomacy 101. That's fucking aged well, hasn't it? That's fucking aged brilliantly. Diplomacy 101. We knew the sanctions wouldn't work. Perfect. Absolutely perfect. Oh, and this is great, because one thing you're going to be able to do a lot of at the moment is find people that held a particular stance like a couple of years ago when this looked to have been averted to where we're at now. You'll find loads of contradictions. Defiant Els is going to be so busy. United States Senator Brian Schatz. Fantastic name. Brian Schatz. Here's Brian Schatz. He's got some thoughts, right? Because what you'll notice in the media, strong uptake for let's unify. No more divisiveness. If you're not with Biden, you're a traitor. By the way, did we say no divisiveness? No, we actually meant you're a fucking traitor and you're committing treason. But if you're with Joe Biden, even if you're Republican and you support him, we'll let you off for now until the next time. And then it's fucking whatever talking point we need to do to call you a neo-Nazi again. But Brian Schatz says, look, it's more essential than ever we rally round our president as he leads the free world in response. If your instinct is to try and turn this into a partisan political advantage or a viral tweet, he said, hoping for a viral tweet, step off the stage. Well, nice sentiment, okay? Let's have a look how he was when Trump was having a few wobbles. Iran is vacating its nuclear agreement after pocketing the money. North Korea just had another missile launch. The trade war is hurting American farmers. Debt and deficits are at an all-time high. Our international reputation is at an all-time low. The president has failed. Yeah, none of that rally around the fucking president and the crisis sentiment I noticed then. Hypocrites and liars and thieves, all of them. Every politician. Ooh, yes. John Kerry, of course, is like some fucking environment czar at the moment. This is how he spends his fucking time, where he identified what the real problem was. What are the concerns, John Kerry, the special presidential envoy for the climate? This is, again, 24 hours before the invasion. What were you worried about, mate?
Concerned about Ukraine because of the people of Ukraine and because of the principles that are at risk.
Good. Good so far,
In terms of international law and trying to change boundaries of international law by force, I thought we lived in a world that had said no to that kind of activity. And I hope diplomacy will win. But massive emissions consequences to the war, but equally importantly, you're going to lose people's focus. You're going to lose certainly big country attention because they will be diverted. And I think it could have a damaging impact. So, you know, I think hopefully President Putin would realize that in the northern part of his country, they used to live on 66% of a nation that was over frozen land. Now it's thawing, and his infrastructure is at risk, and the people of Russia are at risk. And so I hope President Putin will help us to stay on track with respect to what we need to do for the climate.
Well, won't somebody think of the ice sheets at a time like this? Climate change, yeah, it's an existential crisis. The people in Ukraine right now, the situation in Ukraine right now, you can't come out and go, yeah, I am worried about it. I'm worried because obviously people might lose focus on climate change goals. Like, mate, read the fucking room, you cunt. Holy shit. What else? Oh, yeah, here we go. This is a goodie. Always. Come on. Holy. These people really do tweet too much, eh? I don't understand. Like, how do you tweet like 20 times a day? Like, if you're not talking directly to someone, how do you think I've got 20 thoughts that are it's worth people hearing? Right, sorry, this is taking a while. I'm trying to find it. I'll tell you what, while we're here, right? While we're here, I'm going to show you the worst thing you've ever seen. It will be the worst thing you'll see all of this media coverage. It cannot be beaten. This is Anna Lynn McCord. She's an actress, of course, a human rights activist. She founded something called The Love Storm, which is about stopping hate around the world. And she figured out, some people have already seen it, and they know. She figured out the way to fix this situation was bad slam poetry. And trust me, this is worse than even 22 Jump Street. Cynthia died for our Cynthia. This is fucking appalling. I'm going to pour a drink for this, I think.
President Vladimir Putin, I'm so sorry that I was not your mother. If I was your mother, you would have been so loved, held in the arms of joyous light. Never would the stories plight the world unfurled before our eyes, a pure demise of nations sitting peaceful under a night sky. If I was your mother, the world would have been warm, so much laughter and joy, and nothing would harm. I can't imagine the stain, the soul-stealing pain that the little boy you must have seen and believed, and the formulation of thought quickly taught that you lived in a cruel, unjust world. Is this why you now decide no one will get the best of you? Is this why you do not hide nor away shy from taking back the world? Was it because so early in life, all that strife racked your little body with fear? If I was your mother, if the world was cold, I'd have died to make you warm. I'd have died to protect you from the unjust, the violence, the terror, the uncertainty. I would have died to keep your life. Oh, dear Mr. President Putin, if only I'd been your mother. Perhaps.
It's only halfway, guys. I hope you saved some cringe.
Ascription to such fealty against that world that you thought was so cruel. Perhaps you would hold dear human life, and on this night, instead of Mother Russia, you would call me, and I would set your mind quite free with the love that only a mother can give, and only a mother can take away. When holds, she doesn't harm at bay and leaves her boy for the promise of a man. Whatever your story, Mr. President Putin, I can't imagine how it feels in your heart, but I know if I was your mother, I would be a start towards the awareness of what a powerful being of light you could be if your mind was only free from the violence you've seen when you were just 2 or 3. I cannot believe I was born too late. In a different place when I would have loved you so. Watched you play wherever you go.
It's not even the end, by the way. That it cuts off. There's like another little bit after that. Man, holy fucking shit. These narcissistic American liberal fucks. What? Oh, it's fucking crazy. It's over. It's over. And then everybody clapped. Great. Anna Lynn McCord, like, holy shit. Put it this way, I'm pretty sure the Ukraine could probably, if you just bombarded Moscow with that, you could probably get fucking Putin ousted in a fucking evening. Holy shit. This one comes courtesy of our old friend Siraj. Let me tell you, obviously, some of you might not be regulars. You might just be dropping by the stream to see what's popping off. My friend Siraj Hashmi runs something called The List. The List is all of the worst tweets on Twitter. He has a great podcast, The Habibi Bros. He's been blowing up as well the last few months. He's been on my show, been on my podcast. Super cool dude. Basically, like, he's had the nightmare because there have been so many bad tweets. He's had to go through and list them all. I saw one on his timeline. I was like, holy shit, this is wild. This is from Walter Schaub. Fox News hosts haven't lost their minds. They know exactly, because this is all Fox News' fault, you see, in the mind of a liberal. They know exactly what they're doing. They want for America what Putin has, a murderous authoritarian regime. They don't mind the killing. They envy it. They don't mind economic ruin if it comes with unchecked white supremacist rule. So that is pens at the ready for that one. You have been listed. You need your phone taken off you. Let me, oh God, I've got to think about how to end this. I'll just end on, so here's how we're going to do it. Yeah, let's do it this way. Cenk, because you didn't think the Young Turks would fucking stay out of it, did you? What's Cenk got to say about it? Well, at least he's not threatening to fight Joe Rogan anymore. Right wing doesn't love Putin just because he is an authoritarian, tyrannical leader. They love him because he's a white authoritarian leader. Race has become more important than even nationality. They've turned on democracy and now even America in favor of a white warlord. this is all about race. It was about race the whole time, guys. I actually did see a tweet the other day. I dropped it into the Discord, and it was somebody claiming that Lenin... Lenin was actually a black guy. And he got... If you can get it for me, Jace, that would be fantastic. But they claimed that Lenin was a black guy, and he went to Russia and he got a disease of his skin, and they've recolorized it so we can see what he really looked like. I mean, I have seen... Twitter is not a healthy place to be. It is not a healthy place to be at all. You will see absolute unchecked, unfettered illness. Right, here it is. The internet, man, like, why did any of this have to happen? Like, it didn't have to be like this. It didn't have to be like this. It's too good, like, it's too good. Right, this is where we will put a pin in it. Just one last thing to look at. Let's do the China. It sounds like a rather pleasant dance. Let's do the China. I know a lot of people are kind of wondering when China's going to get involved. What's the situation in China? Well, they're certainly dealing with their own shit right now and have their own kind of outlook. This is this was the day before the invasion. Sorry, Lahana, bro. I'll catch up with you later. This was a report on Bloomberg the day before the invasion. China opposes Russia sanctions and calls U.S. actions immoral. This was kind of like... there was a lot of people getting worried about, like, you know, what potential tensions this kind of might lead to. Like, and this is why some people inferred, oh, China will be allied with Russia and it'll be China and Russia versus the world and we're all going to die, which, of course, is delusional hyperbole. But China said they're against sanctions against Russia and said the U.S. has been inflaming the Ukraine crisis, which, yeah... not wrong. Beijing said they didn't view sanctions as the best way to solve the problems. They didn't suggest alternatives and said that the US and NATO have been placing offensive weapons near Russia and saying, have you ever thought about the consequence of angering a major power? Which, of course, China would say that. So that was the 23rd. So a lot of people were like, uh-oh, this is going to end badly. People didn't know which way it was going to go. But then the invasion took place and China gave a very sane and measured approach about the situation in Ukraine initially. You can see here, this is state media on Twitter. This is literally the Chinese government official outlet. The Ukraine issue is the result of many complex factors. Hashtag China is monitoring the development of the situation closely and calls on all parties to exercise restraint to prevent the situation from getting out of control. So essentially a call for peace and calm and civility in the middle of a fucking ground invasion that shouldn't be happening. But then you started ending up with this weird thing where everyone was going, yeah, well, China, are they going to use this situation while the world is kind of distracted with what's going on in the Ukraine? Are they going to use this to take over Taiwan? Now, remember, the view of China is Taiwan is China. If you've ever worked in esports like I have, you will find that out very quickly. No, I don't give a fuck. Taiwan's its own fucking country. Fuck you. Fuck your bullshit. Fuck your imperialist nonsense. I don't give a shit. I'm all right to say it. But most people in esports, and this has happened to me, I've told this story before about the time I used a Taiwanese flag for a Taiwanese StarCraft player in a tournament, the World Cyber Games, which I think was taking place in China, in Chengdu it might have been. We had people at the event that were pulled by Chinese police and said, if that's your website, you need to delete that flag and replace it with a Chinese flag. That's how particular they are about this issue. Now, again, fuck you, Chinese government. That's where I'm at. But a lot of people in esports don't want to go down that route because if you do, your money and opportunities dry up. And so you'll find people like, you know, I mean, shit, man, even John Cena was doing that shit, wasn't he? Where he was like after, you know, we're between Bing Chilling, just desperate to shill his movies in the Chinese market. One time he accidentally called Taiwan, Taiwan, and had to do an apology in fucking stilted fucking Mandarin. It's a big deal. So anyway, Their view is Taiwan is actually China. It was China the whole time. There is no Taiwan. And while the world was distracted by this, few people were kind of, you know, by the situation in Ukraine, few people had maybe noted like some parallels and like, what will China do? Then in which case we move away from, let's all have sanity and calm in the Ukraine. Let's have a chat about fucking Taiwan, shall we? Beijing says, Taiwan is not the Ukraine. Good start. And it's always been a part of China. They are not the same. And you see there, this is an indisputable legal and historical fact. So don't draw any parallels, guys. And then, again, we're all over here dealing with this fucking shit. Dealing with fucking, like I say, Putin, who thinks he's in the last scene of fucking Scarface. And, you know, say hello to my little war. And over here, China are like, yeah, fuck it then. And this is from 8 hours ago. They sent Chinese fighter jets into Taiwanese airspace. You know, this is what I said. I literally said this before any of this happened. I said, China aren't going to get involved in Russia and Ukraine shit, but they will absolutely use the geopolitical landscape to further their own interests. I thought it might just be fiscal or financial, but now, obviously, turns out, they can also use it to finally fucking take Taiwan back, except not back, because it was always China all along. In fact, actually, as well, I nearly forgot. Oh, God. Yeah, this is bad. Remember that cunt Seth Abramson who used this to sell a book? What could be worse? Well, Mr. fucking Bing chilling himself, and I do await the apology in Cyrillic. He actually tweeted out, if I could somehow summon the powers of a real life hashtag peacemaker helmet emoji, I think this would be a great time to do so. That's a genuine tweet. That's one of the all-time terrible tweets from anyone ever about a war. And he actually is there. If you go to that hashtag, he's promoting his new TV show, Peacemaker.